Go ahead and get started. All right, welcome everybody. The regular monthly board, regular monthly meeting of the Board of Directors of Fairfield PND School District to be held at 6:30 PM on the third Monday of each month. The meeting is open to the public and the public is encouraged to attend. Time is provided in the meeting for public input. The mission of the Fairfield Community School Board of Directors is One Fairfield, where relationships foster growth, protect learners, unlock individual potential, and serve every student every day. It is 6:31, and can I get a roll call, please?
Yep. Megan.
Here.
Dave.
Here.
Christy.
Here.
Mark Porter.
Here.
Mark Thornton.
Here.
Ty Ward.
Here.
Deborah Williamson.
Here.
All right, Superintendent Mishler, do we have any perfections to the agenda?
No.
All right. So I will hear an approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Seconded.
All right. Mark and Megan, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? All right. Motion passes. Approval of the consent agenda. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Seconded.
All right. Mark and Megan, any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? All right. Next, welcome guests. All right, we have Kara Doherty, Trinity Rowland, FMS vocal students coming on up.
Thank you for having us. It is a longstanding annual tradition at FMS right before winter break to have a talent show for the students. And these two, who are both choral students, just had their winter concert, tried out on a duet here, and they'd like to share it for you.
Yeah.
Thank you again for inviting me.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, I was at the Winter Choir, and it was a very good show this year again. No spontaneous breakdancing this year.
What kind of show is
that? I was actually really surprised when I found out Ava had never played drum kit before.
Yeah.
That was great.
We threw that in kind of last minute and
yeah.
jumped right on it.
She did amazing, yeah. Thank you again. All right. Up next, we got a superintendent update.
John, bring it up on the board. I definitely want to take the opportunity to highlight what's been going on, some celebrations. And I typically like to start out with those superintendent goal areas. So just as a reminder, the two goals that the board has set for me were to establish action plans for 80% of our SIAC recommendations, and then to increase district visibility by maintaining time in buildings and community building. And so the last month of November, it was a little low on the community building side at 9.7, just close to that 10%, and then 12.4% time in the buildings for November. And then an update on kind of that portrait of a Trojan. We're really excited to be kicking that off in the mid to late January. So we're kind of waiting on those final mock-ups or the final presentation of what that portrait looks like. And the specific goal that SIAC established was in focusing on communicating that portrait to parents and the community. And I think that ties into something we'll talk about later in the challenges and solutions. Some celebrations, I really tried to focus on student learning to bring us back to, you know, the purpose why we're all here. The high school inducted 21 new inductees into the National Honor Society two weeks ago, which is really exciting and quite the honor for those students. It's a really nice ceremony that we live streamed, I believe. So you can probably go back and check that out if you weren't able to attend. The Washington teachers continue to collaborate. They're visiting other schools around implementing and delivering their new reading curriculum. There's been a lot of positive feedback on that, both from staff and parents. Similarly, we've had some increased support for middle school students, with the 29 students staying on those early outs. So the middle school is offering some additional academic support for students who are behind on those early outs. So taking advantage of that couple hours every other week with a high turnout there with 29 kids. And then at Pence, this is something that is a highlight for Pence for quite some time. They have a really strong data teaming where they're constantly looking at their progress monitoring results and working collaboratively as a team to be responsive to the needs of students as they use both FAST assessments and then the daily assessments that happen in classrooms across all those grade levels. The pictures this month definitely highlight the season that we're in. There's a lot of community outreach going on at the different buildings in helping to make it a great holiday season for all students, all kids and families in the district. So those are what some of the pictures are. We also have Ed Foundation. Those grants were awarded. I think we've talked about that potentially at the last meeting. Those checks are kind of clearing and all those things are being ordered. So that's an exciting time for our teachers and something that definitely sets Fairfield apart from other districts with the support that we get from Ed Foundation. I think it was just over $41,000 that they awarded in grants this year to help supplement experiences in the classroom. So that's really exciting. A couple things coming up this week. We have some more concerts. So it's definitely the season for concerts. There's one going on tonight at the high school, and then a middle school concert, band concert tomorrow. Obviously the winter break is coming up. That's on everybody's mind this week. It's a, you know, high energy with students kind of anticipating that break and the holidays. And then the Stuff Your Stocking community event that's at the high school tomorrow. So it's a fundraiser with Washington Elementary, where kids can come and stuff their stocking with support from our local businesses, again, to help kind of make that holiday the best it can be for everybody. So all students are encouraged to attend, and I know that they extended an offer to board members as well if you were available tomorrow night to help stuff stockings. It's from 5:30 to 7 in the high school gym. So I'll definitely be there and look forward to seeing anybody that can make it. The part that I'm most excited to share, or eager to share, is on those challenges and solutions. And so I'm going to ask John to go to the enrollment. Presentation. So this is data that I think right about this time every year, so in that November to December time frame, is when the board could expect updated enrollment data. So our count date in public schools in Iowa is October 1st, and then our certified date with waiting for special ed is in the middle of the month, October 15th. October 31st. So it makes sense that we compile all that data. That's the day, you know, those are the days that that we use to count served students, which then is translated into certified. And so I probably want to talk about that first before we actually start looking at the graphs. One thing about enrollment that gets a little complicated or complex is that people will talk about it in two different ways. So our served enrollment are the butts in seats is what you'll commonly hear staff or superintendents, even business people talk about. The served enrollment being the students. The certified enrollment is then taking into consideration all the different weightings that students get as well. So for English language learners, they get an additional weighting. For our special education, our students in special education, they could have three possible different weightings. And that certified enrollment is what generates funding. So when Evan talks about enrollment, he's almost always talking certified enrollments. When we would talk about things like class size or the number of math workbooks that we needed to buy, that would be based off of the served enrollment. And so sometimes it's kind of tricky to understand which enrollment are we talking about. And so it's always, you know, good to ask, are we talking about the served number here or the certified? So I just had some historical context throughout the presentation that I have to share with you so that you can see kind of some patterns that emerge over time. All of these graphs and charts that I have to share, I shouldn't say all, I think most, and I tried to source all of them so that if the board were to go back, we could point you in the right direction on where to find these. So this one is certified enrollment over the last 20 plus years, and it comes from ISFIS, as do the analysis statements. And so I'll give everybody just a little time to take that in. I would say as we look through these, when you're looking at the ISFIS graphs, the numbers that are on the furthest to the right are from last year's certified numbers. So there's a couple where, depending on if the information was coming from IASB, where we have been able to update with this year's certified annual report, where it might have an additional year that ISFIS doesn't have, or sometimes when you look at those numbers, because I did a double take even, wait a second, that doesn't seem to match up. It was just the offset in where they were compiling that data from. So any questions on that picture? Okay. So then the served enrollment over that time looks like a similar trend line, but just this would actually be the students served over that similar time frame. It doesn't go quite as far back. Again, this is from ISFIS. Good. So this is the same information, just presented in a little different way. And this graphic comes from IASB. Again, all the timelines are just a little bit different. These are, you know, charts and graphs that are generated in those respective resources that we have. But again, shows that downward trend in both certified and served. This is a representation that Judy Jones and I worked on. And so I would draw everyone's attention to the estimated because the way that we came about calculating the total resident students, that would be the total number of students living in the district over time, we took the served enrollment from each year, and then we added to that our open enrolled out number to kind of give an estimate of the number of children that live in the Fairfield Community School District that we would have access to provide education to. There would be some that are potentially, the real number is probably a little bit higher because there are students that choose different forms of education that we have a harder time tracking. The other thing Judy checked it against was she went back to the October board packets to look at what that open enrollment looked like. And so in the couple different ways that we calculated it, the numbers did slightly vary, but the overall kind of trend over that same time period of about 100, give or take, fewer students in the current year versus, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, just living in the district. So then the rest of the presentation really focuses more specifically on open enrollment. I know in the short time that this board has been seated, we've had, you know, lots of questions come up about open enrollment, and I'm sure we'll reflect more on that as the board meeting goes along. This is again from IASB and splits it out into two separate graphs for open enrollment in versus open enrollment out. And then the next slide shows that more comprehensively, so going further back, and puts that into one graphic that shows in versus out and what the net difference is. Again, also with some of that analysis on the side, those come straight out of ISFIS. Some additional open enrollment information. This is breaking down of all the students currently, well, when we certified in October. So already this chart would look different because we have kids open enroll in and out monthly. We see that in the consent agenda each month. So this would have been as of that count date in October. On the left, it shows us the open enrollment by district. So that's where students are open enrolling from. And then on the right, it's our open enrollment out by district. So that would be where students are open enrolling to. So I'll give you a little time to make any connections or jot down any considerations.
So online, would that include CAM, right?
Yep. Okay. So CAM is one of the more consistent ones, and then Iowa Connections Academy is another. There are others too, but those are primarily the two that people open and roll out to. Any other questions on that graphic? This is by grade, so same information, just broken down in a little different picture. And by grade level, just because it was information that we have on what they fill out, so it was another way to kind of analyze that same data that we look at. Again, keep in mind one thing that can be a little tricky about enrollment is that this has already changed as well. So this is all that snapshot as of October. Not significantly, but you know, things do fluctuate just a little bit. Okay, so then what I would like to get to is a little bit of feedback, and as we think about great information, great to reflect on, it helps paint the picture over time as well as then specifically with the enrollments that we have for this current year and in thinking ahead. When we talk about the why, and I know we've talked about this at board meetings in the fall, not just looking at why students choose to open and roll out or why families choose to open and roll out, but also looking at why students and families choose to open and roll in. We do have some of that initial information about why students open and roll out from the forms that they fill out. So we have a little bit better idea there. We have some room to follow up on what people have filled out in those forms, not required to put something in there. So you could leave it blank, or, you know, there's some that say unknown. So there is some follow up there. But to my knowledge, I don't think we've really ever reached out to the open enrollment in to ask why they're choosing Fairfield. And so we have plans to do that, and just trying to do that in a systematic way that's going to give us kind of the same information on the in as we get on the out. And so what you see on the left, and I would appreciate some feedback here, those are the kind of the drop down in the spreadsheet that we're going to use as possible reasons why people would open enroll in or out. And so if there's something that you feel is missing there that you'd want us to capture, in the form, it's also going to have a comment section as well. So if somebody were to provide some more context, we could include that then as more of that qualitative type of data.
So programming is broad. What are you referring to with programming? Academic or?
So we could put academic behind that. Definitely thinking about, I'm coming here because there's an opportunity here that doesn't exist in my resident district, or that I feel is stronger here than what would be available in my resident district, and vice versa, if people are open and rolling out because of some programming opportunity in these neighboring districts, could that help inform, you know, our future decisions?
Could we mention to them to get more, you know, specific on what is taking them out of the district, I guess, essentially? That makes sense.
So can
like,
you go
like what portion of the district are they not happy with? Is it their building? Is it the teachers? Is it the administration? Is it the senior administration? Just to help us, you know, isolate that in a little bit more, if that makes sense.
So if you're saying then, and that would be, I would envision that in that comments. So if we were to call.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Just find a way to encourage them to elaborate essentially on
their dissatisfaction.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think that just, you know, for us, I think we need to more isolate in on what's driving that, you know. So.
Yep.
So this would be dissatisfaction with their other district that they're coming from to ours.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But what I was kind of envisioning is that the drop down, so I have a sheet right now that has open and rolled out, and a set, like another tab in the same file for open and rolled in. And the drop downs I was trying to create where they would be as similar as possible, so that then we could analyze that data to say how many are started school in Fairfield or started school in their resident or in the district that they're attending, and then they moved, but they stayed going to school.
But for both of them,
where they started.
Though.
Yep. So then the dissatisfaction would apply to either.
Because even if we can look at both other districts as well, we can see if we see similar results from the other districts is what we're seeing there as well. So that helps us compare.
And I assume you can select as many as you want from the drop-down?
I'll have to figure out if that takes multiple.
Okay.
I think it would you'd have to have multiple columns. But yes, I think that's doable.
Right. So maybe in the comment field, there could be more instruction like what Mark is suggesting. Suggestions, basically, in terms of how to get more specific so that you're kind of drawing it out of them more than just the fields. I think survey's great. I also feel like, you know, sometimes families have multiple kids they're taking out. These are families that maybe we need to go beyond a survey. Thank you.
I'm glad that you said it's like you transitioned right to the next thought. So as far as collecting that information more concretely and more up to date for both open in and open out, then it will be what's next. So if that's a place to start, to be able to do some of that analysis, then how do we use that information to inform our decision making? And so some ideas are really around marketing and communication, not just specific to enrollment, but to the range of things that we have going on in the district. So, you know, over the last several months, years, we consistently hear communication as an opportunity for us to improve. I think we have done some things the first half of this year that have helped. You know, we've been more consistent with our staff update that we've gotten good feedback on. again, trying to increase that visibility and just be around to hear more and to communicate better. It's still an opportunity for us to continue to improve. And what we really are striving to do is be more proactive in our communication rather than reactive. Because every question that comes in, we want to give people accurate, consistent information and responses to that. But a lot of the questions that come in are very complex and involved. And so how do we communicate out consistently to help people find the information that they're looking for? We do have a lot of avenues that we share information on already. And so maybe it's, you know, helping people connect to that. It's also getting some feedback from parents and staff on how they like to be communicated with. Some people really, really like to get their information from the Facebook, from the social media feed. Others want to get it, you know, right to their text message or an email coming straight into your inbox. And so what we'd like to move towards is partnering with the Donovan Group, who is a school communications consulting firm. They live in the school communication world, to be able to help proactively communicate around a range of things. But why I tied it in here is really getting towards that more targeted enrollment plan that you're discussing. So how do we, one, first get the information, and then how do we follow up on it? We've had conversations about really just asking that very pointed question, like, what would need to happen for you to return to schools in Fairfield? Or just extending the invitation that you're always welcome here. We want you to, you know, appreciate and respect the choice that parents have, and we would encourage and love to welcome you back if and when that's the right fit for your family and for your students. Also, things that are on the agenda later, you know, this school communications group could help support some of those things as well, should those come to fruition as plans as we move forward.
Just so I'm understanding, the communication out you're suggesting from the Donovan Group in terms of marketing, but in terms of reaching out to families or families calling in, is that an in-house sort of, that's our secretaries talking to families, or is that Donovan Group talking?
No, that's our, so our staff, secretaries, principals, district office administration, will collect that initial feedback. Then working with that communications group to help us figure out what to do with that next. So I do think it's our message that we want to tell. We're not relying on the Donovan Group to create our message, but they would be helpful in disseminating that message and being consistent in the information that people have. And really, it's a celebratory opportunity as well, because we have a lot of great things. You know, Deborah was at a building today, and there were several things from today that would be wonderful to highlight.
So there were a lot of aha moments.
And the same went with the tour that we went on last week. So there's amazing things happening in our buildings and our classrooms every day. And this is a proactive way that we could partner to help tell that story or convey that message.
So Dr. Mishler, is there any way, I mean, this is great information, but it's also lagging.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way that we can get some type of, for lack of a better term, customer satisfaction surveys that can be leading indicators of issues? Mm. You know, using some of this information, the same criteria, but surveying our current staff, parents, so that we can get some type of a leading indicator of emerging issues, instead of looking at lagging indicators and trying to say, okay, how can we fix this? Some type of satisfaction survey that we can continually use, that those scores can be brought to the board as part of even a financial package, because they drive our future enrollment. Those are leading indicators. That's what we really need, is what's emerging on the horizon. Not only what's happened, why are they coming in, why are they going out, of course, but we need something that shows us what's emerging. Because a lot of these issues with enrollment were emerging issues that if they could have been brought up to become visible, may have been able to be dealt with and prevented some of the enrollment. And I don't think it could be anything, you could use the same criteria that you have mm-hmm. and just survey your current enrollment, students, parents, sampling every quarter on a regular basis and get some idea. You know, 80% are happy with programming. You know, if it falls below 80%, we have an emerging problem. That's my thought.
And I know we started doing the survey with the teachers. Have we done that this year? Three times a year, I think. I was going to say, I don't think I've seen any results from the first round.
No, we have not given that this year.
Okay. Still planning on it, though, right?
Yep.
Cool.
So I just want to jump back a couple of slides again, if we could. So, you know, I understand overall that, you know, our population goes down. But I think if you look, you know, you do see other similar districts that are still, you know, having open enrollment in versus open enrollment out. And you can very clearly see where, you know, our trend changes in 2019. I don't think that's a coincidence that was COVID. And there were a lot of unpopular decisions being made within our school district. And I do feel like there's an opportunity to reach out to some of those parents who feel like they were not being heard during that time period. I know in particular that there was a person in attendance of our last financial meeting that said, I'm here to see what's changed. You know, I'm here to see, you know, if the message is different. And so, you know, expanding on some of those questions that were asked in the survey, you know, what can the district do to keep you back? You know, have you reached out to someone in, you know, specifically within the district to address your concerns? If so, who was that person and, you know, what was the result of those communications so that we can kind of drill down a little bit more? You know, would you like to be contacted by somebody from our district?
Appreciate those pieces of feedback.
Did we ever get, because you did some, I don't know, cold calls, but calls to people who have left, right? Did we ever get that data back?
So that's really what this is. So we have the data from people who open and roll out, and kind of speaking, I think, to what you're saying, Dave, these are going to be connections that we make with the current, like, people that are enrolled this year. Now, they've already made their decision for this year, but presumably you make that decision every year. And I would agree that some of the lagging and leading, there might be some overlap in that. The most predictive data that we have for enrollment is really that cohort model that we've seen through the projection model. And I think that goes back to the, you know, just changes in population over time, that our graduating class this year is larger than what our incoming kindergarten class is. So there would be some predictive measure that we would anticipate, you know, fewer students overall next year.
If I may, that just means that we need to hang on to those kindergartners through the whole thing. If we see those predictive models, that's a leading indicator. That's what I'm talking about. Yep. That's an emerging issue that we can see. And so we need to make sure that we're surveying particularly that cohort of students, that 103, you know, in fifth grade, that's lower than our 120 graduating class, to make sure that they stay here. Because if we start losing them, then those trend lines are going to get steep.
Excuse me.
That's all I'm saying. Yeah, that predictive model is very good. That just means that we have to survey that group for satisfaction and emerging issues all the more.
I'm 100% with Dave. We just have to figure out a way to get all these issues solved before we lose the students, and that's the trend. We have to get it fixed as soon as possible.
And are there things we could be doing to help recruit and make those incoming kindergarten classes bigger somehow?
Yep.
Can we be out, trying to get those kids that are going to Cardinal or going to Pekin or Van Buren or wherever they're ending up, so.
Any other questions or feedback?
Which I think a lot of us have seen this. It's just interesting when you put it up on a visual like that of the outbound are all going to smaller schools. If you look at that, at least 3/4 probably are going to Cardinal, Pekin, or Van Buren.
I think over time, looking for what those connections are, all that information is helpful in determining what those next steps are. Because while we do respect and appreciate choice, so inherent in that is that you have a choice, and there might be reasons that one of those neighboring districts is a better fit for you. On the flip side, students that are living in those resident districts also feel like Fairfield is the right choice for them too. And so I know in the conversations that we've had specifically with, is there something that could be done to bring you back? What's going to need to continue to happen so that you continue to choose Fairfield schools? Those are important pieces of information for us to have so that we can build the best programming possible.
I'd say Cardinal and Pekin have also done some investment in their facilities in the last 10 years also.
That brings up an interesting point. So when you mentioned the morale surveys that we partner with, so it's EAB that does that. They also provide research for us. And so there may be some information we can gather just, again, on kind of that predictive. What are the most important things that parents, not specific to local, but from a bigger perspective, what are the variables that parents use to choose where to send their students? Could provide some additional insight as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Because one thing I don't think we've thought about even capturing is whether or not someone's choosing a certain district based on housing availability. Fairfield is notoriously short on housing and affordable housing, decent housing, you just hear it all the time. So there could be other districts that have decent affordable housing.
Well, and I can tell you as a mother of 3 kids in 3 different schools, having one campus is huge, because I had a high schooler, a middle schooler, and Pence, and taking them all to school and picking them all up is a huge time commitment. So, things like that really factor in as well.
So that information could be helpful, down the road for a variety of reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Thank you for putting all this together. Yeah. It's great to see this.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Steph.
All right, anything else? All right, moving on. We have public participation. On behalf of fellow board members, at this time, I'd like to invite any member of the audience that has filled out the form to step to the microphone with comments about items of interest or concern. Although we meet in public, we do not meet with the public, and as such, the board cannot comment or answer questions. Please begin by stating your name in relationship to the school. It would be appreciated if you would limit your comments to 5 minutes. If 10 or more forms are submitted, we will reduce time to 3 minutes per person. We ask that you remember that Iowa law prohibits us from discussing specific employees or their job performance. Do we have any forms?
I forgot to ask anyone. Did any of you guys have any forms? I didn't go around and pick them up tonight, so.
All right.
We have 0.
Seeing none, we'll move on. Thank you. New business. All right, first recommendation in new business is the approval of the removal of Christy Welsh as a district authorized bank signer. Simultaneously, I recommend the addition of Ty Ward as new bank. Oh, wait. Are we going to wait?
We're going to do the informational.
Start with the informational. All right. Sorry, I jumped too far ahead in the agenda. New business A is not a recommendation. It's just reflection and discussion on Larry Siegel's finance presentation. Am I saying Siegel right or is it Siegel?
Siegel.
Okay, I think he said Siegel in the meeting. All right. Yeah, so we, was it 2 weeks ago now, we had that meeting with Larry in the auditorium. And yeah, we just kind of wanted to give some time to kind of discuss everything that we heard and get any questions out or anything that anybody wanted to discuss about it. Does anyone want to start?
Well, I think that the big thing that comes out is the trend line for our, particularly our solvency ratio. It's projected to be at 2.1% at the end of 2024, and that falls below our 8% policy limit that we have defined as what financial health is. So I think as a board, we'd be interested in how do we get that back up above 8%, which is the policy limit. That's that from a board perspective, a governance perspective, we've set those parameters and defined what financial health looks like, which is one of our goals. And now we're seeing a trend under these assumptions with a 2% SSA. I mean, you know, you can, the assumptions will affect that as well. But
yeah, and he kind of had that in there too, you know, where if it was 3%, this is what it looks like. And
but
yeah.
Still, it's the trend line is going to take us below that policy limit. And so as we get into the budget cycle for the general fund particularly, we need to bring that, get that number back up into the policy 8% level. Now, whether we do it all in 1 year or a series of steps, we can also probably waive that as a board too. Okay, you know, but that's a major concern. Is that measure of financial health. That's our cash balances. That's not our credit card. That's our cash. And coming from my world, cash is king. You can say what you want about the unspent general fund balance, the credit card, it's cash. And so that was the major takeaway for me.
Yeah, and I think the 2% SSA, we've heard that from enough insiders that I think that's probably going to be close this year to what they end up doing whenever they end up doing it. So, yeah, and who knows about the future, though? You know, they could go up or down then, but I think 2% sounds pretty good to base our estimates on for now. And I think the 2% kind of median scenario, there was a $1.2 million deficit.
Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, I think that's based on a stabilized enrollment of around 50, where we are now. So that's stabilizing the enrollment, assuming a 2% allowable growth, that SSA.
And
we still have a $1.2-1.3 million.
And only a 2.5% increase in expenditures.
Yeah, that's right. That's so. 2.5 increase in expenditures. So, and we're still reaching that policy limit.
And I think that discussion around enrollment really is important too, because, you know, we can, you know, help, you know, stem the tide of this by, you know, increasing our enrollment and doing all those things we were just talking about. But yeah, he was also, you know, pretty clear when he was saying that, you know, hope is not a strategy. You know, you can't, you can't.
Long-term enrollment growth, that's a long-term perspective. So you talked about looking at the immediate situation and the long-term. The immediate situation is that we're breaching our policy limits. And we need to have a budget that brings us back.
So I guess I would like to understand as a new board member, you know, obviously you're new in your role, but you guys have seen this coming. You knew last year that we were, you know, heading this direction, obviously based on our trend of enrollment. So what has been done already proactively to cut budget. You know, I know there were some positions either eliminated or not filled last year. You know, have you met with heads of departments to strategize about, you know, ways that ideas that they may have to reduce, you know, in their area? Because I feel like those are our best resources as far as, you know, they're going to have the most knowledge about areas that they see that might be, you know, glaringly, you know, easily reduced.
So I'll chime in a little bit on that one. So I just kind of want to go back to a reminder on when it goes to balancing the books, the dollar figure and the who is a decision of the board. Now, there is a misconceptions out there that we did make some on-the-fly cuts last year, but those were all absorptions that were posted till August, the second week, that we were not able to backfill. So I did account for those numbers in my projection model, but it does not mean they can't necessarily come back. It just means there's a give and take. So that is one piece I just wanted to get out there of what I've heard a lot about in the public. In regards to meeting with individuals, we're doing this program-based budgeting. We have met as an administrative team. We have a deadline of Friday, I think Dr. Mishra put on us, to have all of our packages completed. And I think most of the staff are already there, so they prioritize things as core, categorical, and additional. Pending on the direction you guys give Dr. Mishler, we will take those packages before a budget prioritization committee, is that what
yep.
you call it, to prioritize those packages. And if the board were to move forward with a reduction in expenditures or something along those lines, we would draw the line then based on the prioritization, and that would be the recommendation brought before the board to reduce the budget.
Along with that, we have also gathered feedback from staff, and that would include or will go to that budget prioritization committee as well for non-personnel ideas for cost savings. And then we would have that to bring back to the board in the new year as far as ideas for non-personnel cost-saving measures. That was part of the maximizing revenues and stabilizing expenses. And so we would look to do as much of that as we can. And then what's in those additional packages, I think, speaks to kind of what your question was directed at as far as the challenging thing is that every job that every person's doing right now is important, it's valued. And it's things that we need. And so part of it would be re-envisioning, you know, responsibilities and roles and positions that remain. And that's a challenging, again, longer term. What does that look like for next year, for the following years, if people pick up different responsibilities here or there, or they'd be jobs or responsibilities that aren't getting, you know, are no longer done. The one thing, The big takeaway, Evan and I went last week. So this whole time we've been partnering and learning a lot from Pella, from the superintendent at Pella, Greg Ebling, who's been here to visit with our administrators as we started that package writing. And so they're going through a very similar, and actually a very similar target number as well in Pella. And so they had their first long-range planning is what they called theirs, but this budget prioritization where they're learning about those different packages. And a key takeaway is that, you know, just the short term and the long term, you know, again, leaning on the hope is not a strategy, but we can certainly be optimistic that we can stabilize our enrollment or turn our enrollment back to where it was. It wasn't that long ago that our net open enrollment or open enrollment was to the positive, that we brought more students in than we lost. Keeping in mind, there's always going to be some, but if we could get back to something like that, then that those positions have the potential to come back. The other thing that he really pointed to that I thought was, you know, again, it was an aha for me, is that obviously the programming that we provide changes over time. And so it might not look exactly as it looked a year ago, 3 years ago, 5 years ago, but that doesn't mean that that support's not there, the opportunity to continue to evolve and be forward-thinking and creative and meeting the needs. Again, that ties back to the enrollment, right? Like, why are people choosing this place over that place? Because of the programming, potentially. And so we, you know, continue to innovate and provide the best programming that we can.
Just to tag on to that, you know, I've said we need to get within that 8% solvency ratio, but we have to do it in a way that we don't jeopardize our programming, mm-hmm. our educational system, because we can't fix a long-range enrollment problem by cutting our way out of it.
Right.
And so we kind of had have a wicked problem here that I'm sure you guys can fix. But we can't cut our way out of an enrollment problem. If we assume stabilized enrollment, and we match our expenditures, minimize expenditures, stabilize our expenditures to that, then we can start working on our long-range enrollment growth and begin to grow our way. That's my perspective.
Yeah.
So one other thing I wanted to mention, and I think it's important to understand as a new board, so you cannot fix UAB if you're spending without reducing expenditures. On the solvency side, that is a willingness issue beyond my control, but on the board's control, you can tax higher to make up cash. So that's the willingness of the board. If you do not want to go above a certain tax levy, that is your right, which will cause an additional expenditure reduction. But solvency is willingness, UAB is reductions needed.
Mm-hmm.
So, and there's caps on all that, so we're not going to get to 8% in one tax year. But if we maximize that cash for, I think, after 3 years, we'll be back in 8%. But you guys have to approve my budget and, or the district's budget, I should say mine, the budget I present you in April to raise taxes. And it's substantial. We're talking a couple bucks on the levy just to get our cash balance back out. That's your guys' choice. So.
And some of that, I mean, later we're going to be talking about the PEPL. And I know you've kind of run the numbers and you think that, like, you know, if we can move some of our general funds into a new PEPL, that we'd get, that could be, you know, a teacher salary, you know.
Yep.
That's significant. Yeah. The other thing with staffing is, if you compare our staffing with other schools our size, we do seem to, you know, according to last year's numbers, we do seem to be on the heavy side in total staffing. So I'm hoping there are some efficiencies we can find there.
That's because obviously enrollment has declined over the last few years. At Washington School, we are at a tour, and the kindergarten and first grade now just have five groups, not six, as, you know, the first grade has, or as the second grade has, sorry. So there has been some of that already, I guess. So really, the only levers we can pull right now are enrollment, which is a longer term picture, and making cuts in terms of getting this unauthorized, or the UAB to kind of match what we need is the cuts. But also, are there other things we can do within
there's several things that are coming down the pipeline, and we just started a lot of these conversations this month. So like health insurance is going to be a big conversation. That is a non-people expenditure that affects people. So that is not jobs, that is benefits. So there are things we had to move there, or we have the choice to move there. So this year we'll get our new rates if we keep our current health plan as is. We'll see an increase. We'll have to come up with the money to cover that. There's also other options where we can move deductibles to different plans, to different scenarios that could save anywhere from initial glance about the new rates, $120,000 to $300,000. Again, we're talking about people's health insurance. That becomes very personal very quick as well.
Mm-hmm.
So those are some tough decisions I would warn you guys about ahead of time. I think Dr. Mishra and I plan on bringing all those recommendations before you guys at some point to review with as much data as we can for you guys to review as opportunities, not must. We have increased some of our interest accounts for now, but as we know, the market will stabilize. I don't want to get in a bunch of macro microeconomics tonight, but we can't rely heavily on interest forever. We are really high right now on the bank side. I think that will come down, and I don't think it's ever going to be as low as it was 2 or 3 years ago. But we're looking for the new stable on that amount. The PEPL is a big one. I just finished off. It's going to be my annual financial health report, sneak peek. But I think there's about $91,000 there that we spent out of general fund last year that could potentially be moved over to PEPL now the facility plans change every year, but that's a teacher and a half worth of expenditures. And then other than that, it's just continuing looking at efficiencies that we can do on the board, but it is really, really hard when I think 80-something percent of our money was going to staffing, and also don't forget we're coming off this ESSER cliff as well. We've been propped up with millions of dollars for years, and you get used to spending millions of dollars, and that just goes away. So on the fly, it seemed like a huge impact, but we just don't have that income resource anymore.
Yeah, that was eye-opening by Larry, too, when he was talking about, you know, we're not the only school going through this. And he's talking about 175 of the districts have declining enrollment. I thought that was a pretty shocking number to hear. And then, yeah, most rural schools, you know, are going to be struggling coming out of ESSER to make sure that they, you know, stay fiscally responsible.
And then there's flex fund balances, possibly the categorical.
Yeah, so most of our categorical pots of money are now eligible to be transferred into a flex fund. I don't know the PC way to put it, but flex funding or categorical funding is kind of a fake chicken because it inflates my UAB. So if you look at a lot of my categorical balances right now, I have 4% in categorical funding on the books. So if you look at my UAB at the end of last year, I think it was 17%. Well, if you subtract that categorical money out that I can't actually use on anything else, I'm actually at 13%. But if we move some of that money into a flex fund, now it is eligible for one-time expenses on any general fund eligible purpose. And that's the common misconception, is you can't just flex fund your way out of a budget pinch. You can use it as a bridge to buy time, or you can use it as a bridge to enhance programming or enhance facilities or name the thing. I call it the board budget, whatever you guys want to do that is legal and ethical. You guys have to approve all those expenditures. That's what that money can be used for. Now, with that being said, we need to make sure we are taking a hard look at what we're using that categorical money on currently. Our preschool programming, our professional development, our homeschool assistance program, our talented and gifted program, all those people get designated money from the state for a reason, right, wrong, or indifferent. So we need to make sure we're providing all those opportunities as well to the best of our ability.
And to Dave's point earlier, you know, cutting, you know, something like preschool, that hurts your long-term enrollment, because we've talked to other districts where preschool is a way to get people into your district and keep them in your district. So yeah, it's one of those things in the long-term strategy or long-term planning committee or whatever, you need to take a hard look at making sure that, you know, prioritizations take that long-term look at all of our stuff.
Where a student starts their education is where they're most likely to continue. I mean, there are obviously lots of factors that cause people to move, but that's a key predictive measure, where you start school. Friends, you get comfortable, all that.
And I was telling you before the meeting that I actually started listening to the Pella meeting, so I heard you guys get introduced there, which was funny. So yeah, they're already doing their committee meeting right now. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to look to be doing ours next month, right?
Yep, so that was on the update at the beginning as well. So those are mapped out for the 10th, the 17th, and the 24th. And where we're working on that right now is to really balance that that team to have, you know, equity across all of our buildings, across all of our programming, to have feedback from teachers, associates, secretaries, auxiliary, and then parents as well. So our target number for that is right around 20. Our principals will participate in that as well. Board is welcome. I think if you watched, then they introduce some of their board members, not to participate in the prioritization, but to observe the process. So we'll get, you know, more into that as it gets closer. We are going to try to wrap up that who that team would be by the end of the week. Fingers crossed that we get all that ironed out. So that people have time to prepare to come. And the key for that will be that that group is not tasked with saying, this is what, they're not cutting people's jobs. They're not, you know, they're providing input ultimately to me, to bring that prioritized recommendation forward. So we will also have our district leadership complete that same prioritization process that will provide, you know, those two pieces of input, as well as the bigger picture and looking for efficiencies and being able to compare. So then ultimately that would be the recommendation I would bring to the board. And then at that point, the board also has some time to reflect on that recommendation and the feedback that they hear from staff, parents, community, as far as what would eventually be reduced. And the board would have the ability to move packages above or below the line based on where we're at that point. So our goal on the backside is going to be to continue to maximize our revenues and to look at those non-people, non-personnel cost-saving measures. Again, everything we do has got a downside to it as well. We have to weigh those pros and cons, but the more we can bring those cost-saving measures to the board before that line is directed, it obviously just makes the line lower. So that we want to do as much of that as we can.
Have you received a lot of interest? You know, I received this the email that said, click here if you want to participate. Have you received a lot of interest from parents or...
I think that the number today was right at 20, and there was more staff. Mm-hmm. Currently, we're missing some staff in the classified. So it's not just, it won't be that everybody that's indicated an interest in participating right now is automatically there. We've got some buildings that have higher representation than others, and so it is a key part of that process to have, you know, a balance of perspectives. So there'll be some balancing there to do and potentially some more parents if parents are listening or wanting to help participate in providing that feedback. We'd really appreciate that. So we'll send that out again here tomorrow. It'll go back out to staff on Wednesday. And then if we need to, we can, you know, go through other routes as well, phone calls and that kind of thing.
So I did want to mention one of the things I found interesting when we went to Pella is they did post it as a public meeting and they did have a quorum of the board, but the board did not sit together and they were not eligible to participate. But they did go around to the tables and hear the conversations and watch the process and watch people talk about their thoughts and all that stuff. So if you guys map out those days, you are welcome to attend, but it is not a... You can just hear the conversation that's happening in the room. And that's just to separate you guys because ultimately there will be a recommendation on the table and you guys want to
do. What are those dates again?
I believe
the 10th, 17th, and 24th.
Of January?
Yep.
6:30 to 8:30?
I think it's 6 to 8.
6 to 8.
That's good to know because, yeah, I was thinking that we'd have to keep less than a quorum, but if we get a quorum, but we all set apart and don't discuss things.
So that board president had their... people all over the room. They were one was at this table, one mm-hmm. was at this table, one was at this table, one was at this table to make sure they weren't talking
mm-hmm. 6 to 8
board business in row.
I like that idea.
So and they just get real time updates just like we get real time updates. So.
Who's making the selection if you do have whatever? After somebody hears this, and now you have 100 community members and volunteers who's going through that. And
I am.
Okay.
Yeah. And so on that form, if you haven't seen it, it does, when you go to the summary, it does put out like a nice graphic of the buildings that you're associated with. So you can, when I just go to first glance at it, you can see, oh, the bar for this building is really large if we were to just go with exactly who's in there. So, again, just balancing those perspectives from staff, from various roles, and then as well as parents that are that have students in various buildings as well. So not a perfect, you know, exactly this and this, but wanting to balance those perspectives and get a wide range of experiences to help, you know, provide that feedback.
When will we have access to the budget packages?
So we're trying, I did put a deadline of Friday for everybody. I do think we're pretty close. just checking things like grammar and that kind of stuff, that because it would be a public, you know, be shared publicly. Then we'll put those together into a binder that the Budget Prioritization Committee will use. So, I mean, it's a big, thick binder that has, I don't know how many packages right now.
Like 170-something.
And so those are not all additional. That's the total packages. And so that'll be made public to everybody prior to, just prior to that committee taking, happening. Yeah, the committee meeting.
The most time-consuming part is this process is so you get the category, and then you have a justification in there. And why is your justification of it being core, categorical, or additional? Well, there's things like Iowa Code 281. There's things like Chapter 12. There is you're required to have one of this, but you only have to have, or you don't. You have to have one of this, but you don't have to have two of this. So then it's putting those together and making a justification so the people who don't work in education can actually understand.
Mm-hmm.
The decision they're making behind the prioritization, and that just takes a lot of.
Mm-hmm.
I work in school finance. My brain thinks a certain way. When I try to explain school finance, I get a lot more questions. So how do I write those packages?
I've also included in the justification for the additional, kind of the implication of what would happen if this were to be reduced, to help people make that, you know, to use that in their prioritization. And so everybody will come with their unique perspective, and that's important, but it also needs to, you know, we're looking for people that are able to look at the whole picture too, and not simply prioritize one item or one area or the things that matter the most to them, that will come out naturally, but also to invest in the whole picture of ultimately what those additional packages have in them.
I think it'll be helpful to communicate to the general public that this is the general fund, not student activities funding, so that some people might say, oh, you should just cut X, you know, activity, you know.
Well, and then you'll actually find that interesting because there are things that all these funds kind of tie together a little bit. So like coaches,
right,
for student activities are paid for out of general fund. But if you don't have a coach for that sport, now you don't have that sport, so...
Okay,
so it's really so it is all general fund expenditures.
Okay.
But I there's a fine line, and you might be way more right than what I even know.
Okay.
But it's just like, how do you put?
So yeah, I guess.
What activity on there? Like, what about activity fund? I'm like, well, the coach is paid for our general fund, but the activity is paid for. It's just
right.
Gets really messy really quick. Or you can look at things like food nutrition. Well, our staff get paid out of the food nutrition fund. Some of our lunches get paid out of there. But things like a new stove would get paid out of potentially general fund or Pebble or another source. So they all...
I guess that's what I'm struggling to wrap my head around, is I feel like I've been working now for months to understand how these finances work.
Yeah.
And how you're going to make it concise enough so that people can make these decisions within such a small time frame when they don't really have... already an understanding of how the finances work. And maybe it'll make more sense when I see the way that you're...
So it goes, so you'll see first grade programming. This includes five teachers, $550,000. Chapter 12 requires me to have first grade programming. Board policy says I can't have more than 24 in a class. One additional, five sections, puts me in guidelines of 24. Six section reduces class sizes to 20. So five is corps that have to do that to meet policy in Chapter 12. The one below that is additional because I don't have to have that to be within our guidelines. Does that make a little bit more sense? So that's, it's more as grouping them together as second grade cost X amount of money, third grade cost X amount of money.
Right.
My position costs X amount of money. First individual detailed,
And there's two parts to the prioritization. So depending on the number of additional packages that you have, it can be cumbersome to then do the forced prioritization where you say A versus B, A versus C, A versus D. If you have 100 of those or 75 of those, and you know, they use the example when we were at Pella that, and you just take 15 seconds to make that decision on each one. They were looking at a total of like 13 hours, and that's not feasible. Or reasonable. So there was a first step in just kind of ranking the priority as like vital or important or mm-hmm. less important mm-hmm. to narrow down those additional packages. And then ultimately, it's not the prioritization committees. They're not looking at the overall, like, oh, what's our target number? And we've got to group things together to get to that. They're just doing the forced prioritization, this versus this, which is more of a priority to me. And that's why we want that range of perspectives, because what's a priority to you
right.
might not be the same as Christy's priority, or, you know, the teacher versus the auxiliary staff, or the parent of lower elementary versus the parent of a middle schooler or a high schooler. And then at the end of all of that, the computer program kind of spits out the ranked prioritization. And like I said, then our district leadership team does the same. And, you know, Greg has been through this several times. And so it's always interesting, he said, to see like the consistencies in that, where at the end of the day, kind of how those shake out. Again, not a perfect, nothing's a perfect situation when we're facing what we're looking at. It's, you know, I'm not really that excited about the meetings and being in the position to need to do that. But as we've talked about numerous times through the process and the perspectives that we can get from various stakeholders and really helping us in the long term. So yeah, this was a short term, let's get the budget, program-based budgeting packages written, but it does help us reflect on our programming and look to see, you know, how do we maximize all that categorical money and avoid those large carryover amounts in the future. Again, nothing we can do to go back and not pointing any fingers or saying that mistakes were made. They built up over time, and you do want some carryover, and so there's a balance there too, and those categoricals are all impacted by enrollment, and so they change over time. So it's just, it is, so I appreciate that you've been working for months to understand it, and it is complicated. I'd go back to the enrollment presentation. I've wanted to do that for a couple months, but you look at it at this place in time and it looks this way. You look at it at this place in time, it looks another way. So you look at certified versus served, it just does get very complicated. And so we have to do our best to help simplify that, and then packages do help do that.
Another nice part about this, and it leads into Dave's point earlier, and I was saying about this when he was talking, lead indicators. You will know what people are prioritizing within this community by that group. So if they prioritize Evan, you will know, help me out. Because he's not a good example. I'm the one sitting here, and I have a good example on top
nice
of that.
Job.
But it's a really good...
But you know what? So
like, when you're making decisions
quote.
In the future, yeah. When you're making decisions in the future, you will know, hey, but that was like the number one priority of the people that did this. Like, shouldn't we be doing more there? Or maybe doing a little bit less? What's the stable and what's the fine line? So it's a really good indicator of what our financial goals should be sustaining to.
And programming goals.
So it gives us good data that way.
So Evan, when you were talking about the flex funding, so how exactly does that work and how much money will that actually free up? But you say it only frees you up for a period of time. Is that what you said earlier?
Yeah, so I'll go back to the one that we just did recently. So homeschool assistance program, as of June 30th, 2023, had a carryover balance of $432,000. So as of June 30th, 2023, that was indicated at the close of books that all expenses for the previous year were met. I was going to carry that balance into the following year. Therefore, I had a one-time opportunity to move a portion of that money, and we chose $375,000 because we wanted to leave a little bit of money in the reserves to flex into the flex account. Once that $375 is gone. But that it can sit in that flex account as long as we want it to sit in that flex account until the board takes action, usually in June before I close my books. I'll bring up action of everything we coded to flex one for the year. And there will be another public hearing, and then they will speak. The board has to take action for me to keep it coded under that line. Here's a risk of doing that. We'll bring Flex One recommendations throughout the year. If I code it there and set them the year, and then you guys say no, I'll find another place to do it because it's already been spent. So it's one-time money from prior year carryovers. So in June, my goal this year would be coming, if it's not all spent out, which would be the ideal world, I'd plan on bringing a recommendation to Flex Fund, this carryover and this programming to build that as a recurring theme to free up our categorical balances to reuse it for another purpose within the school. And that was a common practice in my last district. I did a flex fund transfer every year at closeout. And most of our money went to marketing the curriculum. That's how we built a marketing and curriculum budget. Another indicator on the flex fund too, behind that I'd like to mention, is there's a lot of expenses that we incur that you cannot pay for inside the categorical funding by law, but you can pay for it out of flex funding. So all these people that are paid for out of like homeschool tag and all that, teachers can be, but all the administrative staff, not me, I'm talking payroll, accounting, secretarial, all them are not allowed to be paid for out of that fund, but they're supporting that service. So it's a way to support that service in a different way as well. A simple method behind that is we get a restricted and unrestricted indirect cost rate every year. So if you take a percentage based off the state unrestricted indirect cost rate, transfer that out, it covers, in theory, the expenses to run that program. So. Sorry.
And to get back to the budgeting process, I'm excited for it because the stakeholders do have a direct line of input to it. Those decisions back in the day would have been just made around this table with you guys sitting here answering questions and then public comment, you know, letting us know what they think. Now we're going to have an actual interactive process between us and parents and teachers and community members. And so I'm excited to see what we get from it. And it's got to be better data, you know, just to get more input on it like that. Like you were saying, leading indicators. We're talking directly to our customers, you know, and our employees. And we're finding out, you know, exactly where our priorities should be.
Anything's a lot better than what we were doing before, so.
Yeah, it's got to be way better than what we were doing before, for sure.
I still have just a concern about the committee of 20 and the selection process, and just we're going to be hearing the opinions of those 20 people. I mean, because, and it may be, you know, some people may not feel represented. And if that's just your decision, that might also present some concern too. And I'm just wondering, is there a way for more feedback, you know, just to have a broader consensus on who these 20 people are in this process, so that
we talked about it a little bit, just, you know, how we were going to pick them. And I really didn't want the board to be handpicking who we want on there. Like that seems to be just would be another symptom of the problem, that, you know, people unhappy with board decisions if we were handpicking the 20. Mm-hmm. I wanted to make sure it wasn't us that we're trying to get, and we open it up to the public.
No, I guess maybe you're misunderstanding. I just don't want it to be, if Dr. Mishler is receiving, you know, 50, are you the only person who will be going through the applications and selecting them? Because that's a burden of some sort to just go through and determine, is this, you know, does this present enough variety of opinions?
I think it's indicative of the way information funnels in and decisions, and then that information funnels back out. So absolutely there would be the input from our building leadership, our district leadership as well.
Who's being on the committee or additionally with the budget packages?
Well, they're going to do their prioritization. Right. Okay. But as far as creating that committee as well, so, but at the end of the day, there is a person responsible for making that decision, and that would be me. Now, do I take input from others and help use that input to guide those decisions? I do. And so, like, right now, Evan and I are looking at I think he has a collaborator on the form, or the interest form. I think this is another example of that management, day-to-day operation of the district. So
we just have to make sure that sample is representative of the general population. We can't have it weighted, as you said, towards certain certain groups. If it's representative of the general population,
correct,
then we can be sort of confident.
Yeah,
that we're getting.
I just want to make sure we're doing the right steps to make sure we've picked the right team. You picked the right team because
my goal would for that to be as balanced as possible.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
if you were to go, if you were to go on an extreme, if you, you know, there will be staff who are in additional packages, and so if that staff, I mean, you could, I don't know the right way to say that, or you could, in another sense, there's a program. Like I said, if you're on the, if you were going to participate in that prioritization process, you, most likely, we all have our own passions, interests, and it is going to be really important to be able to look at that bigger picture. And so if you only had the perspective of, or all of the committee members had a common connection to the district, that would not be a balanced team. So. I would really lean heavily on the 20 being, you know, a manageable work size group that, that we can get that good balance between staff within the district and parents in the community, to have that balance and that range of perspectives across all of our programming. So again, back to homeschool or to, parents of preschoolers or staff of preschoolers, staff, and parents within those, categorical programs. As well as, you know, the bigger, the whole picture as well.
I do kind of feel like it's also important to maybe reach out to, you know, a few community leaders, like different, you know, maybe somebody from Cambridge or Agra or the hospital, or, you know, just to have a perspective outside of parents and teachers.
Most of the, well, not most, all of the people who have indicated interest play, have multiple hats. So I mean, I think that comes through in the way that they're responding. So
mm-hmm.
it gives you the opportunity, and you can click multiple boxes. So
yeah.
If you have students in multiple buildings, if you have, you know, background with different programming, your different, you know, roles within the district, or within the community as well. So,
okay.
Yep, I think there's an opportunity to capitalize on that.
Thanks. Yeah, I just want to make sure we're. I know they're not making the decisions, but their impact, their value, their input is going to be extremely valuable to
mm-hmm.
us, and I want to make sure,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Yep, and I'll warn you either way. I've done this a few times. It's not fun. Either way, this room will be filled. It was filled in my last district twice, and it didn't matter which way you did it. It's just, it's tough.
Just one other budget point. If, you know, someone suggested, you know, well, you should sell Lincoln School, I just wanted to bring up that something like that won't necessarily help us with our general fund aside from potential utilities.
It'll be a one-time
like
miscellaneous income,
uh-huh.
so you'll be able to put that on there. It kind of turns into like a flex fund. It might buy us time.
Okay.
Now the coding of what I put that back into is property. Does it go property general fund, or do I go to where we did the sale of real estate? Do I put it back into a PEPO account? Do I put it into a same account? Depends on the negotiation. Sale of real estate obviously takes place in closed session with, yeah, closed doors with realtors. So until I saw that exact detail. So it's an opportunity, and that was a route we wanted to go at some point. But it's one-time money, so we can use it once.
So you're saying the sale of Lincoln can go into the general fund one time?
It depends on how the sale agreements were in. It's just like buying a house or selling a house. It's you have all these negotiating contracts, and quite frankly, I don't want to speak too much on that, so I'll be calling our attorneys to come through that whole process for us. So how that sale real, because I don't know how Lincoln was bought. I don't even know if I was alive when Lincoln was built. So
you were.
So sorry, Dave, not again. So there's this, yeah, it could be one-time money to be used for one-time things.
It's very difficult to place a value on that school, though, because...
And that's another piece. I've heard there's been discussion in the past. I wasn't part of any of those meetings, so...
There's been a lot of schools given away over time from different districts, so how do you place a value on that particular building? I don't know. So...
Land might have a
yeah.
And when Larry Sigel is saying we need to cut between 800 and 1.8 million, he means
ongoing
every year. So, like, one turn, one time doesn't really help that very much, except for in the very short term.
It just buys us enrollment, you know, time.
Right.
And it would help with the ongoing expenses of keeping that building.
Yeah, any of those.
Well, I think that one in particular we've talked about, there's not much that I don't think there's much utilities there. And
they've cut off the power.
Yeah.
Or not the power, but the water.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. We've talked about it before. It didn't seem like it was very much at all.
Are you even heating the building at this point?
No.
I don't think so.
No.
I think our total expenses in that building last year was like $5,600 or something like that.
So, yeah. I think ongoing, we're not doing much there. It's just storage. All right. So, what we do, we want to give a recommendation for a number. If we're going to cut for next year, I think we need to give some kind of number so that the budgeting committee next month knows what they're looking at. If they're going in blind without a number, then we don't really know where the prioritization line is going to go. So, are we comfortable giving a number?
I personally am not, without seeing the information that they're going to be seeing. Like, without knowing what information they're going to be presented with, I don't feel comfortable giving an actual number of how much to cut.
Is it critical That's that we give question. A number, or can they just rank and then, you know, within the next month we can, you know, review? I mean, is there a value in giving a number right now for this process?
I would speak a little bit on that. Yeah, the first step is always giving a number. The second step is on how do you meet that number. And when emotions are high, it is really hard to stick to that number. So if you guys have a gut feeling based off what you have seen or what you have been shared, or you need more information in regards to the financial picture of where we're heading, I'd be happy to present that, but the number is key. Also, I also start budgeting processes very shortly too, so it'd be really good for me to have a idea in my brain.
So do we, it would seem that we could, instead of giving an exact number, I'm not prepared to give an exact number tonight, but you could back into something like that if we said that the solvency ratio of the district needed to be 8%. I mean, it's got to be above our policy limit, or do we waive that policy limit and we accept a 2% solvency ratio for this next budget? You could back it. You could then use that number to begin with a stable enrollment, and assuming a 2% SSA or whatever, you can minimize your expenses or stabilize your expenses around those numbers. I think we could do that tonight.
Just say we want to stay within board policy.
Do we want to have a solvency ratio of 8% in the next fiscal year?
Do we know what our unspent will be at the end of the year? What will
was
carry
that
13? Over? Is that what?
I'm pulling it up right
sorry.
Now.
Okay, thanks.
I'm having trouble hearing. Speak up a little louder.
I'm just trying to get to, I guess I'm, there's a lot of charts and graphs I'm still trying to understand. So, you know, what that number is, what we're carrying over from this year.
So I'm going to end this year's solvency ratio 2.1, assuming no major changes, and a UAB of 19. Next year, so the budget we're preparing for, if we were to make no changes, I'd be ending the year with 15.3% UAB and negative 9.1% solvency.
Yeah, so that UAB falls within our policy limits right now and projected, but the solvency ratio has got to be above. Do we want the school district to raise the solvency ratio to the policy limit of 8%? To do that with a 1,500 enrollment stabilization figure and assumed 2% allowable growth or whatever it is, you get a revenue stream, assuming that we didn't raise any taxes or anything else, and then you stabilize your expenses around that. You come up with an optimal staffing level. I think we can do that tonight. We can't give you an exact budget, you know, cut this, because I don't know.
Well, for me, I would just, you know, lean on Larry, and his kind of middle projection was the 1.2.
Right.
And that seems like a kind of reasonable middle ground number.
And that's probably
and in his
and that's probably what we'll get to under
yeah.
those parameters.
So if we were to max out our cash reserve levy and to get to the 8%, it'd be a $1.5 million reduction. So that's max cash levy of $2.4 million and a $1.5 million reduction. So the conversation on the table is,
do we want to waive the 8%, keep it at the stable 2% it is now and work on it in the out years, or do we want this occupancy ratio at 8% if it's our policy? And if we do, that's what we're telling.
So that math works out to about 1.5.
Mm-hmm. If we were to do, you're working at an 8% solvency and max out the cash, so it'd be twofold there, increasing the tax levy.
We have a policy limit right now of 8%. Do we want to waive that policy limit for this next budget year, and then allow another budget year to get to that, or do we want it all in 1 year in this next year?
I think we have to be realistic about doing that all in 1 year. Yeah. Is going to be difficult for the functionality of the district.
Yep.
I also
not,
think
not saying I want to waive policy, but I think we have to be realistic about what we're going to be trying to do in a year.
I think that that's probably true.
Yeah.
Yep.
I also think that we are hiring a superintendent, and I don't think it's kind of, you know, if we just punted this year and say we're not going to cut anything because we don't want to make that decision, it would be really detrimental to the next superintendent to have to do that. I think anything we can do right now really helps our pool of superintendents, knowing they're not walking into having to make $2 million worth of cuts next year because we didn't make one point whatever this year.
So
I think the key is to start that process, and we just have to determine an actual dollar amount. And I do agree doing an actual dollar amount tonight without more information is difficult. But
I think we can say, Evan, is it feasible to maintain that 2% solvency ratio in the next?
Your Excel's working overtime.
I know.
That's why you pay me.
So maxing out cash would only give me to 0.7%. So to get to 2% solvency, we need about $500,000 this year, so max cash and a reduction of $500,000.
Is that feasible?
It's up to the board. I'm not gonna make that recommendation on behalf of the board.
I'd be uncomfortable with a number that's only that low, $500,000. I feel like that's us kind of punting to next year.
So you're thinking somewhere closer to $1 million?
I mean, I'm just listening to what Larry said. I mean, whatever his projections were, mm-hmm. 800 to 1.8. You're saying that to be within our policies, it'd have to be about 1.5. He was saying middle ground about 1.2. I don't know what other information I could get that's going to change the numbers, because Larry is kind of one of the foremost people in the state of Iowa, and he's looked at all of our numbers. I kind of trust that his 800,000 to 1.8 is going to be the range that it has to fall in.
Well, can we just do this? Can we at least waive the 8% policy limit for this next year? And then say it has to be above 2% for the next budget year. And that will get us somewhere between 500,000 and 1.8.
We can waive policy, yeah. I don't think we can't do it tonight. We definitely do it at a different time.
Requires a recommendation,
right.
A motion and a second, and all that good stuff.
I think that's the way we ought to attack it, is that we have a policy breach. We need to waive it if we're not going to demand an 8% and $1.5 million in cuts. We need to waive it for this next year and then set a minimum so we don't reach the negative. And
yeah, it sounds like
take us within a range.
Sounds like any number we come up with less than 1.5, we'd have to waive that.
Yeah.
I think the biggest issue is without truly knowing what that is within the functionality industry, it's hard to come up with a certain number. But are you saying you just need to give you a set number to work towards and then they can work within those confines, essentially?
I think one point that Evan was getting to is that if and when, whenever a reduction would come before the board, that will be highly emotional. Like you mentioned, the room will be filled. We'll hear from a lot of people. And so setting that number or determining that number at that stage, that would be very difficult. Because we're all human and we're in a very tight knit community, and what's above or below, whatever that line gets set at, I just want to help protect, the integrity of the board too. And with waiving a policy, it can be done. Again, I think there would just be, just everybody going into that, understanding that what the impact of that is. So if we went down a totally different road, we have policies on, a range of things that govern everything that we do. Are we setting that, does that become a precedent where, we have policy for a reason and those are important and we do review the policies. And that's, the time to make those adjustments. So I just would just bring that as a topic for caution.
If we don't waive it, then we're looking at $1.5 million.
Things is difficult to come up with a hard number beyond $1.5 million, because after that we're basically just coming up with a number that we all think is in total.
Well, and the other thing is that we are working on, like I said, on the proactive side, because our goal would be to make that line wherever, whenever and whatever that is set at, to be as low as as low as it can be. So we are continuing to look for ways to reduce our expenses that are non-personnel related. But there's only so far. I don't want that to be I don't want to misrepresent what that could be. We couldn't get all the way there in non-personnel.
I'm kind of lost right now, though. Are we just giving recommendations, or are we going to take action?
There's no vote on this whatsoever. We would just be talking about kind of what our goal would be.
That's my recommendation, is that we waive the policy for this budget year. It's a financial policy. It's not a district personnel policy or anything. That's a financial policy. It's our definition of what financial health is. And we set a minimum of 2% solvency, and we want to be back to 8% in the next fiscal year. So it gives us 2 years to get to that point. We set a minimum so we don't get to a negative. And then Evan, you can back into that number using the assumptions of stable enrollment, no tax increase, a certain SSA percentage, right? And you can back into that number. And that would be the number that you would take to this budget committee.
Why no tax increase?
So you don't want to say no tax increase?
Well, I just throw that out.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think I'd be in favor of no tax increase.
If we're gonna say 8%, then definitely a tax increase is on the table. We can't cut $1.5 million. But if we do it that way, that gives us 2 years to consider it. Consider levies, consider programming, that we don't cut programming to defeat an enrollment problem in the long term. And we give everybody a chance to have input into the process.
Right. I mean, we have to be really careful, because if we cut 1.2 of programming, there could go so many more enrolled students.
And we're asking 20 people to set the priorities for that big of a cut, even if they're representative of the population.
I'd caution a little bit there too, that I don't, that'll be a part of that first meeting conversation, that would be a heavy burden for stakeholders to carry. They're really providing the input to the superintendent to make that recommendation.
Still, with a multi-year, if we set those parameters, we buy a little time to get the input and to consider a tax increase if we need to, consider the budget areas, and we're not piling it all in one, even though we're getting a new superintendent. They would be, they would have the expectation that they would have input into this, I would think. So my recommendation out of that is just that. It's just
so one interesting aspect I want to bring up to you guys, and I don't know your thoughts on it, is our Moody's score is currently sitting between A and AA, which is our rating for bonds. So as you're thinking facilities, that is impacted by our cash on hand. I don't know what you guys have thought about of when you want to go to bond. So obviously with more cash in the bank, the better rating our will go. This is also in my annual financial report that's coming, but currently the best rating is AAA. Dave probably has more experience than I do of rating the bonds, but we're currently sitting between an A and AA right now on our cash.
And what that rating does, even though it's for a full year, that widens out the population of people that will buy your bonds. And so supply, demand.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to protect that rating, but right now we're in a budget. So, you know, that's my recommendation, is that we set a 2% minimum. We waive the 8% for this year with the stipulation we'll get to 8% in the next year.
Mm-hmm.
I really worry that's going to...
We assign those assumptions. We give them those assumptions. We agree on those assumptions and say, okay, now do a budget.
I was just going to say, I really worry just our pool of superintendents that are going to be coming in and knowing that we're going to need to make further cuts when they come in. I would love to be able to hand whoever we hire, because, you know, one of our most important jobs is hiring a superintendent and keeping the school open by being fiscally responsible. These are two of our big topics right here. I would think that good candidates would like to step into a school that's already made a lot of the hard decisions, so they don't have to become unpopular in their first year and make further cuts or do whatever they need to do. That's kind of my concern. I would kind of rather do a little bit more than what you're saying, just so that our pool of superintendents know they're stepping into a better situation than stepping into one where they might become unpopular very quickly because they have to continue doing cuts next year and whatever.
I personally agree with Dave. I think that, you know, it took us years to get into the financial position that we are in right now, and I think to expect us to fix it in 1 year is unrealistic. And I think it's totally irresponsible to pick a number when you don't have any idea what you're going to be cutting. That's my personal feeling.
Yeah, so is the number just to give to the committee for them to shoot for something? Like, what's the...
Yeah, the committee kind of sets what we're cutting, so...
But they're just doing rank, right? So they're just saying this ranks above that. They're not saying
it really
this ranks above that and, oh, by the way, we saved a million here, let's go do something else, right? Like, there's mainly just picking a rank of, if it comes down to these two, this one's over that. They have,
for me as an individual, one individual as a part of a whole group of people that would provide that input. So I don't know that the committee needs that budget prioritization process is hinges on a number, but it is, as far as the ongoing process of all these steps that would inform getting to next year's budget, it does provide the direction.
Here's my question. Say we set this number for them, but then once we see this, we're like, okay, well, we feel like there's more cuts that can be made. That doesn't mean we can't cut more than that number that we're telling them. It's just a guideline for these people. It doesn't mean ultimately that that's what we're going to do as a board, correct?
Correct. At the end of the day, the determination on a reduction is would happen at the that's what the board would vote on when it's all, I don't want to say it's all said and done, because this is all an ongoing, ever-changing, but our goal would be to not set the district up to have to do this repeatedly.
I think
for obvious reasons, range of reasons.
A board just at a 30,000 foot level should really set the assumptions, and then within those assumptions, a budget is set, and then we approve the budget with those assumptions. That's what I'm advocating. So that it's not a specific number, and I know we're taking a risk, but if we set those assumptions like I outlined, I think we can do that. We can give guidance that way. And then a budget can be constructed, and then we can say, yeah, we agree. Instead of a number or whatever, let's set the assumptions behind it, agree with it in our governance role, and then let our superintendent, let our business officer and these planning committees, as a representative sample of the population, put together a budget that meets that criteria, those assumptions, and then we see it, and then we can approve it or disapprove it. That's what I'm advocating right now. And I'm saying that I'm not comfortable with just saying, you gotta get back to 8% this year, because that's 1.5 million. And a superintendent would come in and see, oh my gosh, they had to cut this program and this teacher and this, and it could be a worse situation. So we say 2% where we are now under this enrollment assumption, no tax increase at this point in this year. We set those assumptions, put together a budget with the idea that we're going to get to 8% in the next year. That's what I'm advocating.
Evan, you did a $1 million last year at Charles City. Did you guys have to cut programs?
We didn't cut a single program.
I think that kind of goes to what Christy's saying. It's like we're trying to make this number, and we don't know what we're looking at here. We don't know what values are attached to any particular. So it's already intense because you're asking us to, it's all conjured at the moment. It's some sort of made up space of what things are actually costing on a program level.
I think it's going to only get more intense once we get those attached to it.
We don't have any information. So it's, you know, I see the need to bring it down, but I see there's a financial need, and then there's, you know, a whole health, morale, like, district, you know, measure as well. And we have to really ease out of that in a delicate way. And I know big cuts are better than lots of little small cuts, but maybe, you know, slicing the pie a couple times is more valuable.
I think the one thing you alluded to is you want to make sure you bring the superintendent in. I mean, the number one thing that we can do for the superintendent is keep a functional district with good morale and, you know, everything intact, you know. So I think that we could all probably agree that 1.5 million that quickly is going to be just too much, you know.
How much did Pella say they're cutting?
One.
So
one.
What did you cut for a million? Like, how did that happen? How was that successful?
It was 5 teachers, 2 administrators, 1 bus driver, and 3 support staff. Mainly at-risk programming. So our dropout prevention, we moved to from having 2 at-risk coordinators to paying our counselors 100%. We cut a music position. We cut a director of communications. We cut a administrator, a bus driver, so we reduced one route. Because we went to 71 passenger buses, so 65, and the 3 support staff. Oh, our library associates went to 50% SPED para and 50% library, so they went to the library for their study hall period, and then they were able to go under categorical special education for the remainder of their day, so that equaled out to 2 FTE. Some of that was through some natural absorption. Some paras left, we just didn't backfill it, so we said, you're now covering these deals. A lot of that is possible. I will mention before the board, some of these things that shake out of these things do require board action on involuntary transfers. That's not the job I signed up for. So, well, that's the position we have now. So that's the other alternate end of it, is we might be able to get the money on the fly, to say the least, but then we're going to have to come before you guys going, hey, we want to do this to save the budget. Here's an involuntary transfer. That's uncomfortable too. I mean, so.
So 10 FTEs.
It was 10 FTEs.
That doesn't sound quite as disruptive as we're all kind of imagining, I think.
Well, and the other thing, in those packages, there's not an individual program where the whole programming is additional. So going back to just the categories of packages, there's a core required aspect to the programming that, you know, we wouldn't be at risk of not having any second grade teachers because we have to have second grade. We have categorical money, but the categoricals have changed over time. Who knows, you know, there's another big question mark out there as far as what happens legislatively in the new session, because there were, you know, obviously some really big changes last year with how we could spend specific categorical funds without having to flex it out. So all of those things are moving pieces as well. And at the end of the day, that committee and our administrative, you know, director, or district leadership is back to what I think Mark was saying, is a priority just at a very simplified level of this position or service or program, however you want to look at that, compared to this. I pick this. Now I do it again with this. I pick that, you know. And over a range of those, that feedback, it produces a ranking.
How many early retirements do we have so far?
12.
12?
4 teachers and the rest are support staff.
Mostly support staff?
4 teachers, the rest are support staff.
Okay. I've turned their papers in so far. How much more time do they have to do it?
January 12th. And some of them went back out as well.
So if we just absorb some of those, we're already close to our number.
So then that's...
Already close to your
million. Here's an alternate... devil's advocate on that one a little bit. Now you are directing the superintendent to make those absorptions to take the heat without the prioritization and the budget.
Mm-hmm.
So should we be backfilling that or not doing it? So we're trusting her judgment on just to absorb, which takes the pressure off the board. I understand that, but then what if someone really, really prioritized that package and we should probably actually backfill it and prioritize something else? Now that's not even showing up as an additional package or a core package or anything anymore. It's just out. And we may never know. So that's the downfall of.
Yeah, I was just speaking hypothetically. I don't want to short circuit the budget process. I definitely want to go with that.
100% up to you guys. I just want to
remove
give you guys all the odds and ends
for people
to
rank or prioritize. So.
Okay. Well, I think that's a little bit clearer than what kind of looks like.
So the one thing I wanted to hit on off all those conversations, and honestly, Dave and I, we have talked. Obviously, I love the cash side of it too, and the cash is what is outside of our policy. But the UAB drop is what gets you in trouble with the SBRC board or the state of Iowa. That's the one I'm actually kind of a little bit more concerned about right now. I think we can slowly build the cash back up would be my recommendation, but we need to make sure our UAB is at a healthy spot as well. Which I know is kind of counterintuitive, but if I'm going, what's going to keep me out of Des Moines?
Mm-hmm.
Advocating, spending all my time to not get in trouble. First, the willingness issue of, do you guys want tax or not? Or cut expenditures. So I just want to, so that puts us, I'm right at within policy, and then by FY 2026, I'm outside of policy at 9.8% UAB. So that's kind of the realm. We see it now, and then it goes at 5% really, really quick after that. If you guys want some highlight schools, go read Davenport in 2020. Iowa City just had a big go before the SBRC this year. The state's in your guys' seats telling them how to do their books and making the cuts for them. There's a couple other smaller schools, so that's why I... Cash side, I like it as a counter that helps me make payroll. UAB as well puts me in Des Moines.
10% is the lower end.
Our policy is 15 to 20%.
Oh, 15 to 20.
And we set that policy back in August by recommendation of myself, Matt Gillespie, and Larry again. The reason why it used to be 5 to 15 used to be the guidance. But right now we are balancing the game of educational savings accounts and that impact. So we went from a $9 billion public education fund. The $7 billion public education fund. So we don't know where that 25% is coming from, when, where or if, along with there's new laws out there with the flat tax rates and property tax forgiveness for military and senior citizens. We get funded on property tax, so there's less people paying property tax, which means we have less more money. So they're recommending a higher UAB to weather the next 2 or 3 years until we hit that new stable ground.
If we focus on the UAB, okay, and we get up to above 15% UAB under that assumptions, what's the cut?
How far out do you want to be above 15? How often?
Like in this next budget year. It's our policy.
So going into next budget year, if we absorb all the COVID money, I'm literally ending the year at 15% as we are right now. And with a maxed out tax levy on the cash will put me at 0.7 cash at the end of the year. So if we were to absorb nothing and max out cash, I'd be at 15.3% and 0.7% cash on hand at the end of the year.
Okay. So what is it? What's the expenditure effect?
So that would put us 4% over budget, or 4%. So that'd be a $961,647,000 decrease in our fund balance and our UAB moving forward, so about $1 million.
So
impacting our authority.
So we target the UAB at 15%.
And that's about $1 million, you're saying?
With a enrollment stabilization at 1500 or whatever the enrollment stabilization figure is, the 2% SSA and no tax increase for this next year, right? Or is it with cash? There is a tax increase.
That
with
would
the
be
cash
a tax
levy.
Increase.
Okay, a tax increase with the cash portion of the uniform levy.
Which
that's
$1 million. We didn't levy much in cash last year, right?
We were below 4,000.
We're below expenses.
Third.
Yeah.
That's so. If we're going to levy something, that would be a target.
Yeah, we were levying and managing
that
for years instead of cash.
Is that it?
It's a board's decision. She takes her guidance and I listen to her.
That would be my recommendation on how to do this. That would get us up to our policy limit of 15% UAB. Under those assumptions, we're approving those assumptions, we're stabilizing our enrollment. A cash levy increase. We're already low in the cash levy. Cash levy increase, and then whatever you think the state allowable growth will be. That'll get us about That'll be about $1 million in expenditure adjustments.
100% with you.
And we just tell him that's the assumptions that we want to go.
So you guys good with that?
Mm-hmm. When they prioritize, they'll see this line, what's above and what's below or not. It's just for us when we come back and we review everything.
Correct.
Okay. And I just want to throw one thing out. I would agree with Evan. Having been under regulatory scrutiny 3 times in my life, you don't want to be there.
We won't go there.
Yeah, we don't want to go there.
Yeah, Davenport, the SBO at Davenport was not painting a very good picture of what they've had to do. So
I will say in
it's
the big
terrible.
Districts, it's usually a political stain. In the small districts, it's incompetence. And so that is
anyway,
usually the theme.
Just to move this along, I would recommend that that's how we approach this. We back into that.
That sounds very logical. Mark and Mark,
sounds
you guys cool?
Me, so. I'm with you.
Back in.
Okay. Does that give you guys enough guidance?
Are you guys okay with it?
I think hearing Evan's experience helped, you know, understand what it was like to reduce, and focusing on the UAB
I liked hearing that no programming was cut with your million-dollar.
But yeah, and I'm also with Christy in that I need more info. I need to see it. Well, you know, and we will.
We'll get a budget from that we will have to, you know, and we have to make sure when we get the budget that it meets those assumptions.
Yep.
Because that's what we're set.
And those dates that Dr. Mishler pointed out are really great days because that's a great opportunity for you guys to get walked through it with the group as well. I see the binder. I'm sure she'll send it out whenever, or send it to Ty, or however that's going to work. But we wrap it up Friday and then move forward. So
I think, Mr. President, I think we're all on.
All right.
Evan, does that give you enough? Dr. Mishler, does that give you?
Yeah.
All right. Good discussion. I know those discussions are hard, so I thank everybody for participating in those. That's good. All right. Moving on to the thing I tried to read about an hour and a half ago. All right. New business. Recommendation approval of the removal of Christy Welsh as a district authorized bank signer, simultaneously recommending the addition of Ty Ward as the new bank signer for the district's approved depositories, including Iowa State Bank, Pilot Grove Savings Bank, Iowa Schools Joint Investment Trust, Midwest One, and UMB Bank. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Deb and Mark Porter. I'm going to abstain from this vote because my name is in there.
And I will have to abstain, too, because of my affiliation with one of the financial institutions.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Motion passes with two abstaining. All right, next. Recommendation to approve the School Budget Review Committee modified supplemental amount of $524,227 for the at-risk and dropout prevention program for the 24-25 school year. Do I hear a motion?
Mr. President, I move approval.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All right. Dave and Megan, any discussion?
After that email, I think Ty was going to send out today. Did you send that out?
I did. I sent out an email
today. Is
there
any question? I know this is an annual thing, but I know there's five new board members, so I just want to make sure you guys have understanding of what this program is and what I'm actually bringing before you guys. Is there any question on that?
I appreciate you answering those questions, too, and I like to be able to get that info out to you guys before the board meeting so we don't have to.
Well, I appreciate those questions. I get going fast because it's such an annual thing in my brain that I really appreciate you slowing me down on that. So.
All right. Hearing no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Next up. To approve a resolution ordering election of the question of continuing to levy a voter-approved physical plant and equipment property tax. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I'm going to give it to Megan. All right, Deb and Megan. And discussion.
Mr. President, point of order question.
Sure.
So this is an increasing the levy rate to $1.34?
Correct. We currently have a 67 cent, and this would be an increase.
Thank you.
We have three, I think, opportunities to put this in front of the voters, March, November, and then the March after that. Or is it the November after that?
It's March, September.
March, September.
And then the following March.
And then the following March. Okay.
So all we're doing right now is approving it to go to vote, then, essentially.
Correct.
Yeah.
This would be approving it to go to a vote in March.
In March.
So it's not like we're doing anything to approve it.
Right. No, we can't approve this. This has to go in front of the voters. It has to be on the ballot.
So there's two PEPL. So there's a voter-approved PEPL. They can go up to $1.34. Then there's a board-approved PEPL for 33 cents that comes before you during budget time. So it's a total of $1.67 on the levy you could have for physical plant and equipment levy.
So you say it's an increase. What is the reason for increasing right now, and what will those funds be used for then?
Yeah, absolutely. So our intent right now is we have a lot of additional repair costs impacting our general fund, which I feel is negatively impacting our curriculum and our staff due to repairs that are needed in mainly our middle school and the high school in Pence, Washington's doing all right, but the majority of the expenses came from the middle school. So for in order for us to maintain a health or a safe and health working environment for our staff, I would like an increased voter PEPL to move those expenses from the general fund to also help protect the staff. It also allows us the opportunity to borrow against it for any future big projects. So instead of doing a full $2.70 geo bond, but you guys will have the opportunity to potentially borrow against voter PEPL and save revenue.
Yeah, I think Matt Gillespie, last time we talked to him, he was talking about borrowing against the PEPL, and if we increase this to $1.34, it got us $10 to $15 million more in possible borrowing against it.
Over the length of 10
10?
Years.
Okay. Yeah. So
five more. It would double.
Yeah.
Essentially what you could borrow.
So if the voters vote this down, essentially it would just stay what it currently is. Is that how that would work?
So it stays at 67 cents for 1 year. We can go to vote again next year. And if it got shut down next year, we'd be without this money. Mm-hmm. And it'd be about $890,000 of money we would have to move back into the general fund and balance those expenditures. So right now this is a renewal of a already existing voter PEPL at an increased rate to maintain our facilities. We do have the option. I did not put it before you guys in this go around, I guess, to do a portion of this on income surtax. But according to legislation, income surtax might be going away in the next 2 to 3 years.
Jeez.
So I'd rather have it on the full $1.34 property tax now to see it so the voters know the impact if they were to approve it. Instead of 3 years down the road having to go before you guys go, hey, house file, whatever passed. This is now on your property tax and trying to re-explain it all. So that is my reasoning by not implementing income surtax. Also, if you implement an income surtax, you cannot borrow against the income surtax portion. So it limits the flexibility. Right now, I think we'd have an excuse for some of the income surtax, but say we get a bunch of nice new facilities, now we have money to stockpiling that we can't use anything on. So
if we vote against this tonight, say, and then it didn't go to vote or whatever, I mean, essentially, the main thing it would affect is you guys just wouldn't have the money to maintain the facilities like we need to right now.
Correct.
Long term, it would dig into our general fund, which would cause even more issues functioning in the district.
Correct. And our PEPL supports all of our one-on-one technology for all of our students. And it supports all of our transportation expenditures to get students to school. And then we always do a big project with PEPL every year too. The parking lot repaving, you saw the high school. This year is the concession stand. It's getting used for the PEPL in front of the baseball stands, and we are capped out in December between the concession stand and just to cover our transportation cost.
Evan, can installation of solar panels be paid for out of this fund?
Absolutely. PEPL and Safe can cover things
which
like solar and renewable energy.
Which could further protect the general fund because
yep,
that's where our utilities are coming from.
Yep, that is one.
Which could also make it more marketable when it comes to vote that this is something the funds could be used for. Go ahead, Dave.
And this would affect our long-range capital planning because of the borrowing capacity, correct?
Correct.
And we would have more follow-up on that in January when Matt comes back to visit on all levy implications. So not just with PEPL, but the bigger perspective as well.
How long have we been down at 67 cents and how did we get it that low? Just out of curiosity.
So voter PEPL is a 10-year renewable thing. So if you guys were to vote this in, it'd be on for the next 10 years. So it'd be 2034 to expire. So back in 2015, they would have brought it before you guys at 67 cents. There's probably an initiative at the time or based on the expenditures needed at the time, 67 cents. Cover the current expenditures or current needs. So
most districts do the 67 or the $1.34. They're is a range in there, but those are by far the two most common.
Do you have any statistics, just out of curiosity, like the number of districts that do the 67 cents or the number of districts that do the $1.34?
More and more are treading towards the $1.34 with the increase in maintenance costs. It used to be 67 cents, which is the common one, but most are going. So I want to say last I checked, there's only like 135 school districts left with 67 cents, 325. And then there's like a 20 of them that have failed PEPLs, so they have no PEPL right now. And then the remainder are all $1 to $1.34.
Yeah, when I looked in our area, I think like Washington was at $1. They're one of the oddballs that aren't at either 67 or $1.34. They were at their $1.30, whatever it is. They were $1, but yeah. It seems to be all over the place, but most people are higher than the 67 around us, it looked like.
And it would begin in 25 because our current levy, our current PEPL goes to...
So if we pass it this March, so you're allowed to go to vote up to 2 years early to give yourself opportunity. So if it passed this March, which we would know hopefully March 7th after the vote day on March 5th, I'd probably be able to get it on this year, which is due April 30th, to start seeing that impact immediately. But with that being said, there was a caveat that I heard at one time, don't quote me on this, that you might be able to keep your current one and then start it the following year if you were trying to do something else with your tax levy as well.
So if we were not to push this through, I guess, what would we, I mean, I guess we already talked about what we'd be sacrificing, but I mean, would it put us in a dire situation or not?
It puts us pending a loss of almost $1 million in revenue stream that we are currently budgeting off of.
That's dire.
And gives you fewer chances to pass that.
And to tie that into, and I guess the third thing I kind of forgot to touch on the $1.34 as well, is with the property tax rollback change and the property tax forgiveness. When you receive less property tax, you receive less revenue. So with those rollbacks, that $1.60 or that 67 cents does not go as far as it used to. So the $1.34 to get even to a stable amount of revenue that we've been seeing before us over the past few years, it almost requires you to tax at the higher rate to make up for the same revenue stream you've been used to.
Mark, what's your concern?
I think at this point you just let the voters decide, so I'm just honestly just trying to do a diligence to make sure we all understand what it is that we're voting for, you know.
Okay.
So that's really what I'm doing.
It's a tax increase.
Potential.
So, you know, it just has an effect on a lot of people, you know, naturally costs everyone more money. I want to make sure that money's well cared for, which I know it will be, and I want to make sure it's needed. But at this point, I think probably the wise move is to probably let a good vote, let the voters decide. So
I just pulled up the spreadsheet of just our AEA kind of comparables in our area. Like Oskaloosa's at 67, Fort Madison's at $1.34, Keokuk $1.34, Mount Pleasant $1.34, Fairfield we're at 67, Centerville's at 91 cents, Sheridan's at $1.15, Davis County and Alvia do not have a voted PEPL. 67 has 67. Mediapolis is at 17 cents.
And just, this is an important thing to clarify after I heard the $91 and $1.15 year old, like how they do that. If you prove a $1.34 PEPL during budget time, you do not always have to tax the full $1.34. Mm-hmm. You can tax up to $1.34. So their business managers are like, I only need 91 cents next year. Mm-hmm. So that's probably what they put on their budget. Mm-hmm. So the $1.34 is the max you can't go over.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot about that, so thanks for reading that. So,
is it correct to assume these other districts might have other, like, general obligation bonds or something, you know, something that taxes are being paid on? Maybe
yeah, a lot of them have some big capital improvement.
So there's a different, more complete tax picture, not just
PEPL.
Yeah.
Was it Alvia that just lost by like 4 votes or something?
Yeah, we did. There's a couple others that just lost by
so
a handful.
So if we vote to, you know, yes on this, then it goes to vote. I mean, is there another step where there's education to the voters on you know, the need for this.
Yeah, so I think that's might one be thing we're talking
that
about.
That goes on to the next, recommendation.
So the next step would be, and just put in context, I was going to wait till the January board meeting, but I have to have this filed by January 19th. I was trying to hope to get Matt in here sooner so you guys could see the actual impact on the tax strategy. But the intent would be to gather with you guys to really piece together your guys' priorities and when we get in facilities management and all this other stuff of what we want to sell, what you guys start kind of thinking about what you want to use it on as well. We all have, I mean, we have a wise facilities director who has all these things that need to be completed, but we can start using that as selling and marketing tools. You know, concession stand's really cool. Resurfacing a track is really cool. Solar energy should be really cool. Light bulbs would be really cool. So just like, oh, how?
Yeah.
Also, to tie it to our last discussion, we were talking about, you know, expenses that would currently go out of general funds and could go out of PEPL. Yeah. That's like an, what do you say, a teacher and a half?
That's like 91,000 when I looked at it.
Yeah, so it helps.
Then I could confidently say we should have that over here.
All right. Any further discussion? All right. Move to vote. All in favor say aye.
Hold on.
Nope.
This is a roll call
vote. Nope. Gotta have a roll call vote.
I'm filling out papers. I have to file with the county. So, Mr. President, if you can remind me, the motion was by Williamson.
The motion was by Deb and seconded by Megan?
Megan.
Yes. And the motion on the table is to approve a resolution ordering election of the question of continuing to levy a voter-approved physical plant and equipment property tax. And move to roll call vote.
Dave Eastburn.
Yes.
Megan Dow Robbins.
Yes.
Christy Kessel.
Yes.
Mark Porter.
Yes.
Mark Thornton.
Yes.
Ty Ward.
Yes.
Deborah Williamson.
Yes.
Motion carries. Anything else you need from us on that one?
I need your signature.
All right, perfect. All right, moving on. Sorry, I got to flip a bunch of pages now. Next point of business, to approve the proposal from the Donovan Group as presented. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All right, Mark and Mark. Discussion. So who are the Donovan Group?
I hope in the information that came out to you that you had an opportunity to check out some of those videos, some of the content and the graphics. We were, you know, briefly discussed the Donovan Group as a school communications consulting firm earlier when we talked about enrollment, but it's more than just, you know, targeted enrollment plan or marketing towards that. It really is a comprehensive communication service. And what's really advantageous about the proposal is that they're allowing us to sample their services that I think that even in the documents they described as the kitchen sink. So they will provide anything and everything that we would want around communication, around marketing, around messaging, again, speaking to the question from just a second ago, around the A Voted PEPL, why, what that would get, what that would mean for the district. At you know, again, month to month, to try that out for, you know, the next few months as we navigate through different, I mean, that happens throughout the entire year, every year that we navigate through different decisions. Again, I would go back to the beginning of that enrollment conversation and talking about opportunities that we've continuously heard as a district to improve on around communication and being more proactive in that approach. Some of these things, it's not, I'll give the example of the presentation by Larry and wanting to get that out quickly, and we have excellent staff that can that have the skills to do some of this. We also all have other responsibilities that that we're tending to as well. And so over time, marketing in schools has just become it's become more important. And you see that It's why we've discussed our brand and marketing that and communicating out around our portrait of a Trojan. And, you know, that kitchen sink approach to being able to test those services out at a time where you're recruiting, you know, the position that the board hires. And we want to celebrate the great things that are happening in our district. It's another tool that would help us do that.
Has the district ever employed a marketing group before that you're aware of?
We have used the Donovan Group for some crisis communication in the past. We do also tap into the AEA that provides some of those services as well. Outside of that, I don't think so.
Not on like an ongoing basis. And within our district, who does the marketing fall to?
It's a little bit of everybody. So when you think about managing our social media platforms, we have everything from district personnel, our building principals and staff, some of our building secretaries access those social media sites and use our thrill share. And it has become easier. We have upgraded those digital platforms to make it more accessible. We have coaches that post results of their, so it's a little bit here, a little bit there. And some that's positive in some ways because you're kind of sharing the load, but that leads to inconsistency, mm-hmm. and it could lead to inconsistency. And are you putting that out? Am I putting that out? Who's doing that? So we have the message, and they help us deliver it in a range of ways. Going back to kind of what we talked about before, where some people want it in an email or a text, others want it in person, others want it, are consistently going to Facebook or Twitter or X or whatever that's.
Mr. President, can I ever recognize to speak against the motion?
You sure can.
I'm sorry, Dr. Mister, but I'm going to have to speak against the motion. I've considered this. I've gone back and forth on this. I see value in this sometime in the future. But we've just made a motion to increase the PEPL to one, to send it to the voters to $1.34. We set an assumption behind our budget to raise the cash levy. So we're going to ask our community eventually to give us more resources. And we've just come into the, backed into a $1 million expenditure adjustment. That's going to impact our staff. It's going to impact our teachers. It's going to impact all of our districts for this year. And I just think that this is a luxury that we can't afford right now. And I'm going to have to vote no in this situation. This doesn't mean that this is not a good idea or that it's probably not beneficial for us sometime in the future. But I just can't, under those circumstances, we can't go to our communities and to our stakeholders and say, we're going to hire a marketing firm. That's going to, and I know that $2,500 a month and $30,000 is marginal. It's probably walking around money on a $27 million organization. But it just sends the wrong message at this time when we're asking the community to give us resources and going to our staff and going to the people that will be impacted by this budget adjustment that we're ready to make. So I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to vote against it.
Now the $2,500 a month that you guys are talking about, does that all come out of the general fund then?
Honestly, this would be a great opportunity to use the one-time money that flex funds provide. And so that would be helping target those enrollments across the board.
Yep.
So the advantage of that flexible funding is that we can still use it to support the programming that it was allotted for, and it allows us the opportunity to support other programs as well.
So it really won't dull at our general budget then, is what you're saying.
It goes back to the conversation then at the end of the year. The risk would be and again, the $2,500 out of the general fund, I don't want to sound like $2,500 is not a significant amount of money, but for the services that it provides and routine costs that we face as a district, $2,500 is not uncommon for us to spend on a range of contracted services that we engage with. So if the board were to get to the end of the fiscal year, as Evan was describing,
And we go through that process of okaying spending out of the flex fund. And that wasn't something that the board felt was appropriate use of that fund at the time. Then it would come out of the general fund.
Now, how would this compare to, like, or I mean, with a portrait of a graduate, you know, or how would these be similar, I guess, would be my question.
So the portrait,
you know, we already put money into that, right?
Yeah, and
so
the portrait we spent mostly TQ, so teacher quality, professional development, to provide those, the specific learning, like when we just did the TQ days, our professional development days, obviously that funding came from there. We were also able to use some Title IVA funds, categorical funds, again, to support that portrait. And I would say that that company, Battelle, would be the closest thing that we've contracted with before on a marketing, in the marketing realm. And total spending that we've spent with them has been significant. It's upwards of 40. And then, you know, if we were going to contract with them to help do marketing specifically just around the portrait, I don't know that they offer the comprehensive services that the Donovan Group does around all school communication. I mean, that would have been another route to go, although I think their scope is much more narrow on what they would help support communication around.
I think with this, you know, I'm a little torn because there's a lot of things that Dave said I agree with, but I also, since the second that I've been on this board, I've been constantly complaining about how terrible of a job that we do marketing our district. It's been terrible. It hasn't gotten any better in 2 years, you know, and
I thought of another.
So I'm very torn on this vote because I agree with almost everything that Dave said. But I also say, believe by not voting through this, I think in my term as a board member, we will not get any better marketing ourselves if we don't do something right now, you know. So I'm very torn, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. So
It is their wheelhouse around communications with specific to school. So as far as a voted PEPL campaign, is that something that we can put together and contact experts or colleagues that have been through that process before? Yes, we can, just like we've done with the financial packages and the decision-making around budgets and all of that. We've been, you know, building a very strong network and reaching out to others. We also have that process to navigate through as well. So, you know, there'll be a significant amount of time invested in preparing for those meetings and communicating out about those meetings. And this would be very helpful in doing that. And I did want to come back to Megan's question about if we've partnered with marketing before. We did test some out last year. So if you remember seeing any of those Y Fairfield kind of flyers, we're in the process of finishing the backside of that, even though that was a project that started last January when we brought in a consultant that came in and she was here for a day and she interviewed different staff members on why they choose Fairfield and put together some really nice, you know, promotional flyers that we then put out on social media and we've got highlighted on our website. And so we do have the intention of, you know, putting some key facts about the district as a recruiting tool as we go into hiring season here in February and March. We will always undoubtedly have some teachers who are retiring, some teachers that move for a wide range of reasons. And it's more competitive now than ever. The tool that we used to recruit applicants in the past was Teach Iowa. Through legislation last year, they totally shut down Teach Iowa and they moved everything to Iowa Works. And when I go in and I try to, we're not the only ones in this situation. So when I go in and try to find our job, current job postings in Iowa Works, it's challenging. It's like, I can't find them. So when we think about the need to hire a science teacher next year, because we're filling that with a long-term sub currently in a building, the tools that we had to do that before, the resources that we had to do that before are restricted, are limited. They're working on it, but who knows how long that takes as well. So it's an opportunity for us to capitalize on their connections across the state as well and helping us put together some of those things. I was just, to Dave's point specifically, it's obviously something that we have been doing without. However, I can't emphasize enough that we continuously hear that communication is an opportunity for improvement, and this is one tool, not the only tool. It doesn't mean that we're not actively involved in creating the messages and delivering those messages and providing that feedback, but it is one tool that would significantly help us in that endeavor.
I see this as a wise investment. I don't think marketing is the district's core competency, and it touches so many things that impact our enroll out, enroll in, recruiting teachers, promoting bonds. I mean, the list is just extraordinary. I mean, the $2,500 a month is pennies compared to what we're going to get on our return. And not just long-term, but short-term. And this contract is for a year. So if we're not on this long list of school districts who are happy customers, current and happy customers, then I would be surprised.
How does the scope of work get determined? You know, I mean, obviously they can't make 10 videos in a month. And we don't have that defined. I mean, can they? For $2,500, that would be amazing.
See, my prior school district is on there. I use them. You literally email Jerry Gallagher.
And they make
videos. And he does it. I need to post for this. I need this. He says 24 hours, 48 hours. Yep, I'll pull this picture. A lot of what I see him do is he'll come spend maybe 2 or 3 days on campus. And he'll walk around and take a bunch of pictures, make some videos, and start compiling all this stuff into a folder. So when we come after him for a project or a need, he already has a file set aside of real Fairfield kids, real Fairfield staff, real videos of our facilities just ready to go to do at
it's
our discretion.
It's like a plug and play. He's made this video for this school district and that school district, so he just kind of uses the same template or something. I mean, I'm just trying to understand how someone can do that much work for 25.
It's a whole team. He's not in it.
He has a whole team.
But even still, it's...
And they probably use templates.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think it's a great value. I think people are looking at video a lot more. We don't have you know, showcase videos. If we want our district to grow, it makes sense. I like that it's month to month.
Right now for the next 3 or 4 months to then revisit, you know, towards the end of the school year, like, let's see what it produces.
So if we don't like it, we can cancel it anytime is what you're saying?
That's my
understanding. Pretty much has a 1 year probationary period of, hey, we'll do this on a monthly basis and at any time I will let you out of it. But come July or August, you'll visit with the superintendent and myself and ask, like, hey, do you want a 1 year? And then you lock it in for a year. Same rate on the monthly payment, but you're locked in for a year, so even if you don't use them, well, you're still paying for the entire year.
And they'll kind of...
Yeah. So here's my question. How many students would it take to... gosh, I forgot the phrase.
Cover the cost?
Yes, yes.
Six.
To justify. Six students.
Well,
for a year. But if you had one student, it would cover the cost of 3 months.
Yep.
Now, I don't know how you're really going to measure that, but in like,
no, but that's helpful.
Yeah, yep. For 3 months, for $7,500, that's almost the per
I have properties
cost
that I invest in, and I want to know my break-even.
Yep.
So that's the word I was looking for, the break-even.
So,
four students for the year.
In general, are you guys pleased with your old district with their work?
Yeah, so I was really happy with him because as soon as we... I just said it earlier, we reduced our communications director, and it was a huge impact. We're learning how to write press releases and do all the social media. So I was really happy just to have someone like, hey, you know, I was going through a reduction, like, help me write a press release on how to tell people why we're doing this that makes sense to common folk. And that was just really nice to have that lean on me. We had a middle school principal experience a really tragic issue with... a teacher in a different scenario, like, how do I deliver this bad news to the public? Everyone is asking me about it. It is super confidential, but people need to be aware. Was able to call him up. He built press relationships with our own local press of just, hey, they're working on this, and talk to them. So I was biasly happy with him, but it took weight off my back as well, so...
I definitely agree that something like this is much needed in our district. I feel like this is very vague as far as what services are going to be provided for that dollar amount, and the fact that it's starting January 1, like, I feel like it needs to be very strategic, and I just question whether we're prepared or we have a plan in place to be ready to go January 1st when we're going to be paying this $2,500. Like, are we ready to go straight out of the gate? Do we have a plan in place as to what we want him to implement? right away? I mean, that seems like a really quick turnaround.
So a few things that jump out when you look at that, the list of services that are provided. You would look at some of that video creation, the campaign development around what was, you know, the voted pebble, social media management. Again, going back to that consistency in the messages that we're sending out. They also do this website assistance was something that we spoke with them about last week as far as a website audit. I get a lot of feedback as I'm out and about with parents, with staff. Where do I find that? And so they come in from, you know, a visitor from afar and kind of audit, hey, let's put this information in this location. They don't do the website development. They did that for a while, and it got to be, it was a little outside their wheelhouse and cumbersome. But the surveys and the focus groups, again, and going back to that enrollment conversation, we gather the initial information, and we work with professional communications staff to help us determine what those next steps are. I really appreciate Deb's pointing out earlier that marketing isn't the core competency of education. It has become more important over time as parent choice has become more publicized, and our open enrollment laws have changed where you used to have to have that done by March. You can now open enroll at any time. So it's not uncommon for districts our size to staff. I think that's what Evan was speaking to that ended up being reduced in his previous district, but to have full-time communications and public relations people on staff, and that would certainly be more than $2,500 a month to employ even a part-time person. So
I guess my other concern was I did look at a couple of the websites listed on here, and I thought they looked very similar to what we have currently on our website. And then, you know, like I'm noticing, like Albia School District is listed here. Well, their Pebble vote didn't pass. So I guess I'm questioning the value.
I would go back to it's a short term. So I think Mark asked about where it was written in here about going month to month, and it's at the bottom of page 102.
I think that's the key. We can cancel it anytime. So you do it 1 month, what's $2,500 if we don't, or I mean, if we, let's do it, let's just say we roughly do it 3 months or whatever, we can pull out at any time. That's the thing I like about it. It's not a year long contract or guaranteed $30,000.
And who's the liaison, like, from our district? Would you be giving them the workload, or how does all, I mean,
I think most of that would filter through the district office, but we have some videos that we cooperate with that are that we work with, the radio station and some buildings. So we have a little bit going on here, a little bit going on there. And so if buildings had a need or something that they wanted to highlight, we've got all kinds of really fun assemblies going on this week. If we had this in place, it'd be a great opportunity to gather some of that footage and, you know, hey, season's greetings, happy holidays from Fairfield Community School District, and seeing the joy and excitement in kids and staff and celebrating together would be a great, you know, promotional video to put together.
This feels valuable, but I feel like we also need a group that, like, is able to give notes on whatever it is, so we don't just get something back that doesn't quite
fit. Somebody's
going
to have to be paying,
needs.
Like, direct attention for things to actually get accomplished, I feel like, because, you know, if you're just willy-nilly, like, sending them things here or there, like, I just don't know how much is actually...
I think their approach is going to be more systematic. I've worked for companies like this, and what they'll do is kind of have a discovery phase of a few weeks where they interview key personnel and try and get a sort of 50,000 foot view of what you have, so what your current state is. And then working with key personnel again, they want to know what your goals are and what your priorities are. And then from that, they'll wordsmith what we can provide. And they'll take us through kind of a question and answer process so that, you know, they can just kind of fill out their templates and then make the magic. So it's going to be the difference between, you know, when you're watching a television commercial that's a father and son commercial that's just homemade versus the really slick stuff that really, you know, makes it rain. It's just a big difference. I don't think we have anything to lose. I mean, to give them a shot.
Mr. President?
Yep.
So just to speak against the motion again, one more time. I I agree with everything everybody said. I'm not saying that this is not a good idea. Eventually, something we'll need, particularly when we get into the, you know, we're in an enrollment fight, we're in a war for talent. But I want to emphasize again that we just set budget parameters to get our unspent allowable budget, whatever that UAB, up to 15%. We're going to ask a cash levy increase. We just passed a motion to send an increase in the PEPL levy to the voters. And we're going to ask $1 million out of our budget that's going to impact staff, it's going to impact our district. This is not the right time for hiring a marketing agency, no matter what the cost or the flexibility, the message it sends to our community. I just can't vote for it at this time. Now, I am not saying that this is not a good idea eventually, that we will need something like this eventually, and maybe this is not the group, you know, that you're saying value. I don't know. Marketing is not my slick point, but that's why I'm voting against it.
So
is because I can't go to the community and ask for those things and then not take a sacrifice at the board level or the staff level for communications. Communications is our responsibility. And I know that this is a tool. Okay. So those are my reasons. I feel very badly about it. I understand the bandwidth that you guys are under, the efficiency that it's under, and I know what I'm asking of you, Dr. Mishler, and you, Evan, if by voting against this, I understand that. But that's a sacrifice we're gonna have to make in this situation. So that's why I'm voting against it. I'm sorry.
Now, we've been talking about the marketing thing for a few years now, and that's the reason I'm kind of struggling with it is I'm always wondering, is there some employee, you know, that could commit, you know, 20% of their time to doing this or something like that? Is there anything in your realm of anyone who's already employed in the district who wouldn't have time to commit some time to doing this for the district so we wouldn't have to hire a firm to do this? Or what's your thoughts there, I guess?
I'm sure that there are skills and expertise that we could tap into. Our staff are currently, you know, spending, they have responsibilities. So that would be, again, that's part of the bigger conversation over some time as far as realignment of job responsibilities. And if, you know, when a reduction takes place, some of those responsibilities still have to get done, or they don't. So to add additional responsibilities, I wouldn't want to say absolutely no way can we get it done, but I guess without this, I am a very growth mindset oriented, that we have the capacity to continue to get better. My communication skills today are better than they were 3 years ago or 5 years ago, but where we're at right now, we are largely at capacity for our ability, you know, in the way that we're communicating and getting information out. I would like to see us be more proactive in that communication. It takes time. And so it all goes down to prioritization, which is exactly what the gist of the meeting has been about from the beginning. So if we put more priority into that, we're going to have to give up something to make that happen. And so in the short term, I would say we would just expect that things would continue status quo. And again, that's we're going to continually work to get better.
Yeah.
But that's in the midst of continually trying to get better at everything that we do. Back to our purpose of being here as, you know, students and supporting their success and learning and being educators.
Because this has always been a thing for me, because I've, you know, since before I was even on this board, I've listened to some of these neighboring schools, specifically one of those districts that gets a lot of our students,
yep,
do an excellent job of marketing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you might not think it has an effect, but I know it does,
mm-hmm,
because I've seen a lot of people go there. I think in my mind, you know, I agree with everything that David has said, and in most situations I would have been the first one to knock this down and do it, but I've sat here for 2 years and watched us do nothing to make an effort to fight to get, you know, I mean, from a marketing standpoint, do nothing to fight to get students who currently haven't thought about coming here, and especially haven't done enough to get the students back that we've had. And I think there's just too many qualities in the district that we're not highlighting. And I think the fact that we can do this on a month-to-month basis and not make a year-long commitment, I think makes sense. So I think you start out, you throw $2,500, $5,000 into it, you see what happens. If we don't like what we see, you can pull the plug out at any time. Right?
And you got to ask yourself, just to dovetail on what you said and what you said, you got to ask yourself, when we, you know, update the public on some of the big changes and the big cuts, and when they ask us, how are you going to fix this? And we say to them, we're not doing anything new. We're not changing anything we're doing. We'll just keep doing the same old, same old. That's not a very good answer. So ask yourself, do you want to be able to say to them, boy, have we got a great plan. We're going to do this, this, and this, and it's going to been proven to increase enrollment, make recruiting easier, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, coming back to the voter-approved levy that we want to happen in March, some money has to be spent to communicate about that. And
yep.
I don't know how we normally do it or have done it in the past, but there's a risk there if that doesn't go through, and this is a potential, you know, way to communicate in an effective way if this is the first project they do. And to the where the funds come from, I know cash is cash, but is there any way that it could come from the tax that we're levying to, because it's specific to that for that particular month? I'm just wondering if, as we do projects, we can find certain funds to fund it from that make more sense, so that we're not always pulling the funding from the general fund, if possible. But like, that was multiple points, but.
when we're managing our presence, like on social media and stuff like that, I mean, that won't cost us any more than what we're currently paying them, right? I mean, it doesn't cost anything to run those ads and stuff that you plaster all over Facebook and so on and so forth, correct?
Yeah, they manage the social media, if that's what we task them with.
So that's
doing.
All within that fee. And that's going to be the most effective form of communication you can get. I mean, it's not going to be going, you know, doing on KTVN or KYU or whatever, you know.
I think so. Also just the releases. You know, we've had a couple releases that we've put out recently, and to be more proactive in that, to say, hey, we've got Matt coming in on January 9th as we work through the agenda. And we want to get that out even better than what we've done in the past. How can they preemptively get some messaging out around levies, around tax? That's what that's really what his session is,
now
his presentation is about.
I listen to some of your ads, like on the radio and stuff like that. I mean, that wouldn't fall within this, correct?
No, that's a separate.
But
I just recorded two of those today.
Okay.
So I guess, yes, again, back to the marketing, we do have some things here and there that we do access. But it is just, at this point, kind of pieced together. So it would be nice to have somebody this is their wheelhouse to help bring that cohesion together around, again, the consistent branding, the consistent messaging. And I think you have alluded to a very nearby district that does it fairly well. And I just think there is a connection there. It's more important ever that we're telling our story. We've been saying that for... We've got to get our story out there. We've got to highlight the great things that we do. And we do our best to do that. You know, I know our principals are working really hard. I know our administrators. And I'm just as guilty as any. You know, I'll go to something, and then at the end I'm like, oh, I forgot to take a picture. I didn't get that post out, because it's not the intention. That's not my number one priority for being there, is to create the post or to sell it. It's important. But I also go for the other reasons, to support kids. And
I think go back to both of your two points of, it would basically be an investment for the Pebble coming up. Like, I think that's where you get the most bang for your buck. Like, if we don't get that passed, we ditch a bunch of money. So the second one is, I actually went to one of the sessions with Jerry up at the School Board Association, and it was basically just on this. Like, he had very good points. He did bring up the Albia one that failed, so I do see the Albia's on their list. He knew right away. I think he pointed out very good points of his vision of why it failed, just because of the community outreach and the engagement there. So I don't know if it was more of a marketing black there than it was an actual community deal. But I think it's just a matter of what are they... Because I think, back to your point, Christy, it's just like, where do we use them first? Because you can't just bombard them, because then the right things aren't going to be getting done. And I think to say that we're going to use them for social media is probably not the right use for them. One, they're not going to know every single day what's going on. They can give you some templates to use and things like that, sure. But I think the most bang for a buck is going to be the vote coming up. That's, we got to get out there and get the public's, whatever. If we want their opinion, their surveys, they hear. If we want to communicate what's coming up and why, you know, some of those why reasons for the public, I think that's where we could use them. If it really is a month by month, I think even for the 3 months till that darn vote is done would be a good use of it.
All right. Discussion seems to be winding down. Any last points from anybody?
So one more on the month-to-month, just because I'm reading this thing, it doesn't make any sense. So the term is for a year. So if the term is for a year, even though they have a one-liner in here that says it's month-by-month, is that meant it's month-by-month after the year, or is that just a gentleman's handshake that is for month-to-month?
The conversation that we had was, they're more than happy to provide this for a month-to-month. And I guess when I read it there, that we can provide the entirety of our services at $2,500 a month. And then what page are you looking on where it says?
The very next one, 103. The
103.
Term, point number three. It says contract will commence on January 1st and will conclude on December 31st, 2024.
Yeah, I mean, we specifically talked about trying it out for 3 to 4 months, so I don't see the... He's saying we're going to pay month to month, and we pay 30 days in advance. So if we don't pay the 30 days in advance, then we're clearly not going to get those.
He's not going to answer your phone.
We're not going to get the services because we haven't paid for them. And, Evan has a good working relationship, and he has worked with us before as well. Like I mentioned, we did just contract for some crisis communication through past events. Mm-hmm.
So the last project, and I'll just give you my insight of what we used them for last, is we ran a geo bond. But what he did right before our geo bond is he advertised our pre-K and kindergarten registration dates very publicly for us. So we had a back-to-school pizza family night, and they all showed up, and he advertised that, and we fed them pizza, and they registered for kindergarten.
Kindergarten roundup and how we do that year, that would be something that
totally
takes place in May.
So that was just an example. What he did every year for us was advertise that. Because we knew if we had a good number by May, June, July, whenever we started it, it really helped me on the budgeting side for the following year.
Wow.
So.
All right. Any more discussion?
The only one, I don't know if you can build this into the clarity, as long as it's month to month. Like, I don't want to buy this for a whole year if we're all in the assumption that we can do it for 3 months and then get that gap. So I don't know if you need to write that in there somewhere or... I don't want to say yes, and then we're in for a year, and then all of a sudden the terminology is different.
I think we can trust Dr. Mishler's call on that.
All right. Go to a vote. The motion on the table is to approve the proposal from the Donovan Group as presented. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say nay.
No.
I believe that was a 5-2. Motion passes. Okay.
Well,
that's what I heard.
I'm trying to remember. You two know.
All right. I would like to call for a quick 5-minute recess so I can take care of some business. And it's 9:25, so if we could all be back here at 9:30, that would be great.
Of course, you embarrassed me.
Out in the middle of the meeting.
All right, it's 9:30. Let's get back to business and try to power through this, shall we? All right. Next recommendation under new business. The first month, approved January 9th, 2024 as the monthly work session of the Fairfield Community School District Board of Directors. Do I hear a motion?
Motion.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All right, I heard Christy and Mark. And discussion.
I'd jump in real quick. So January, well, the first Monday of the month in January is New Year's Day. And so there would need to be some consideration unless the board would like to meet on that day as a holiday. And we do have Matt Glassby coming in on January 9th. And so we would be gathered as a for a board work session already. And so in the consideration of putting those things together, we've already got this scheduled, so that's a good option on January 9th, and we could bring additional work to that work session if it called for that, if we needed that at that time. So.
So the third Monday then is going to be MLK Day. Mm-hmm. I won't be in town that day. I know. Does anybody else have a conflict?
I do.
That's probably different business, but.
is that the day we don't have school that day?
School.
I might be gone that day as well.
You just amend to include both?
In fact, well,
the hard part on the January 15th one is we have early return to do January 12th, and we're supposed to let those individuals know if they were approved or not the next regular board meeting, so it would have to be after the 12th. I've been telling the 15th because of the policy, but if that were to amend, I could let them know. I would allow them or either to know if they got approved for.
So go to the 16th. Can we amend?
Could we amend this recommendation to include the next board meeting also? Or
yeah, you guys can do that to approve the January 9th, 2024 as a monthly work session.
And
but that's another motion to second, so you'd have to have someone propose a
right
amendment. So yes, the answer is yes. If someone wants to make that motion
to amend
within the motion.
What days would work for you guys? I think a couple of us won't be around on MLK Day. Would like the Tuesday, the day after, would that be better? I think it would work for me.
Yeah, it's a conflict with our bank board meeting, but it's the same old stuff.
Can we just move to the following Monday, though?
I think that's what Evan was saying, that you wanted it to be close to that 12th date for the early retiree.
Yeah, we just have respect for our staff who are pending resignation or retirement. I think they're starting to plan, so it's sooner. I told them the 15th.
I mean, I can rearrange on the 15th, that's fine, but on the 16th, too. I can make it work.
The 15th, I'll be flying back, so I don't think I can make it back. Okay.
Is the 15th the day we don't have school, or is it the...
The 15th. School. No school on the
15th. You don't have it the 22nd either.
We don't have school on the 22nd either?
Mm-hmm. Is that a conference day?
I think that's what my wife was talking about being gone, so...
Are you
good?
Good.
Do it the 16th.
Okay.
I may not be here. I might have to be out of town for work, but I could Zoom in.
We could do that.
Do you guys want to entertain amending it to move the regular board meeting in January also, or just try to make it so everybody makes it? Does anyone have any problems with January 9th?
No.
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 All right. If we wanted to move the regular board meeting, someone would have to move to amend this to add it to it. Otherwise, we'll just go for the 15th being our regular board meeting.
But you said you can't be here, Tyler.
How many people are gone and unable to be here on the 15th? Just you?
Sir, we have a vice president.
There you go.
Sorry.
If it's just me, we can just have it on the 15th, that's fine.
And if we move it to the 16th, how many people are totally unavailable? But I could Zoom in.
What if we moved it up to the 12th, so to like a 6:30 on that Friday?
I won't be around the 12th.
Say we don't.
I also have basketball supervision on that night. I would get out of that. But
I say let's just move to the 16th. If, I mean, if everyone can be here on the 16th.
Megan said she can.
In person or Zoom?
She said,
I can Zoom, and I can try to shift my work, but it's not a guarantee. So.
Can you get you a Zoom link, or if you can call in?
So I'm moving for that Tuesday instead of Monday.
Which amend it then?
Sorry.
So we need a motion.
A motion to amend.
I'm moved that we amend the regular monthly board meeting to Tuesday, January 16th at 6:30 p.m.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on the amendment? All right. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say nay. Amendment carries. All right. So now the amended motion on the table is to approve January 9th, 2024 as the monthly work session of the FCSD Board of Directors and move the regular board meeting to January 16th, 2024. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, guys. All right, next order. Recommendation to approve the FEH change order 002, reflecting the revised price of $564,119 from $613,600 for the Fairfield concession stand. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All right, we got Deb and Mark Porter on that one. And discussion. So they're giving us a break?
So we had a $600,000 budget, and it came in at $613,600. So Josh Wiley and his team worked with the FEH group and firm to find areas where we could reduce it within budget so we could still get the concession stand built. But since the original bids that were brought before, the board was $613,600 until we locked it in, this is the new contract to bring it within the new budget scope.
So what are we giving up if we're knocking roughly $50,000?
I'm going to call the guy to the table.
Board recognizes Joshua.
Yes, what we're giving up. So some of the things we're giving up.
So some of the things we're changing from cast iron to PVC pipe, which is a big savings. We're going to do the data ourselves, and then we're going to...
You're going to do the data, you said?
Pre-internet, Wi-Fi.
Okay.
We're going to do that ourselves.
Yep.
And then we're going to remove some insulation from the building. Toiletries, sinks, and stuff like that, I'm going to get through my vendor. I can get them cheaper, through Supply Works. We get really good discounts. So things that we could get to save money is what we're going to do.
Yep.
So.
Insulation-wise, so what are we taking insulation out of them?
So the majority of the building, virtually all the building is the one part we're going to heat, or cool rather, because it's baseball, is the concession area.
Yep.
So a big savings was insulation. There's no sense in insulating the whole building when we're going to winterize it in the winter anyways. We're going to shut off the water. We're going to drain the toilets. The concession stands at the football field are not insulated either. We go in there every fall. We put antifreeze in the toilets. We crack the lines. We drain them. There's no water left in it. The hot water heater, all of that. So there's no point in spending the money in insulation for something that is not going to be used. It's used 2 months out of the year.
Yep.
So.
So it would still be insulation, concession stand part?
Yep. So the concession stand walls and the ceiling will still be insulated, but the rest of it, part of it is, so you got the concession stand, you have a storage unit in the middle, and then you have the bathrooms. Yep. It's storage anyways. There's no point. That's cold storage. It's not going to be heated, not going to be cooled. The bathrooms, there's no sense in them to be heated or cooled. It's 2 months out of the year. Why spend the extra money on insulation? Like I say, the concession stands at the football field aren't now. Every fall, we shut off the water, disconnect all the toilets. We drain the water out of them, pour RV antifreeze in the toilets, in the sinks. We drain all the lines. It's what we do with them now. I don't see the cost. For what it saves us, it doesn't make sense.
Yep.
So, plus we're not buying extra furnaces to heat it all winter. It doesn't make sense. Even if you insulated it, you're still gonna, either you're gonna have to heat it or you're gonna have to drain it.
Yep.
Whether it's got insulation or not.
Yep.
So either way, it's gonna cost us even more money if we put in the insulation in the thought of we're gonna heat it, then we're gonna have to heat it. So,
yep.
And we're not.
Yeah.
I really appreciate you finding cost savings like that.
Thank
That's
you.
That's awesome. Any other discussion?
Is there any facility would be used for others in arts in on a master plan like 5 years, 10 years down the road where we'd want the insulation at least in the walls and we would add supplementary heat later? I just want to ask.
Well, I mean, right now it's summer sports, so I mean,
yeah.
Right now there's tennis there, baseball, softball.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose if we built a football field there, like, but we already have.
Yeah.
So, I mean, not that I could see.
Right.
And it's not that you couldn't put insulation in it later.
Okay.
It's very doable.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be harder? Yes. It'd be easier to do it now, but you could do it later. Blow in insulation, pop steel off the outside, you go in between each joist, you blow in insulation. It can be done.
Okay.
But for right now, I don't see where it'd be used for, you know, anything. There's not a soccer field there. There's, you know, the football games for the JV is all...
Okay.
You know, held at the high school. So it's literally baseball, that's it. I don't see the extra cost in it. Especially when we're talking about budgets and saving money where we can. We had a budget, and that's what we're trying to do.
Makes sense. So.
Thanks for doing all that, Josh.
Yeah, Josh.
Absolutely. All right, any other discussion? All right.
I will abstain from that vote, so...
Where's my motion? All right, motion on the table is to approve the FEH change order 002 reflecting the revised price of $564,119 from $613,600 for the Fairfield concession stand. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. All right, next up. Recommendation to approve the Memorandum of Understanding presented by Johnson Controls to add cooling supplemental heating to the Fairfield High School Gymnasium to be paid through ESSER funds. Do I hear a motion?
Second.
All right, I heard Megan and Mark Porter. Discussion. So is this the last of our ESSER funds then?
What will remain?
We had $835,000 spent this year. Somewhat two bonuses for staff. What was this one for?
$585,000.
We're probably sitting around $70,000, roughly. Unclaimed at this time, off the top of my head. We do have a staff member again paid out of that as well. So for the most part, we're down right to the last little bit of pennies of ours for funding.
Were there any other projects like in consideration for those funds?
This has been a project that's been on ongoing work towards for 3 years, 2.5 years. So not at this time.
Yeah, these ESSER funds were developed before my time in this role. So.
And if we don't use these funds, they go away. So
they go back to the state.
Yeah.
They have to be used by June 1st.
September of 2024 now, but.
Oh, that's good.
They have to be used by September, but they have to be allocated by
obligated by June.
All right, obligated by June, spent by September.
Yep. First quarter of the following.
It's really hard to spend ESSER money when nobody's here in the summer.
Mm-hmm. My only concern, I love this. I love thinking that our high school gymnasium is going to have air conditioning. And you know, I've been in there when... it was hot, and you know, people were kind of weaving a little about to faint. So my only concern is not a huge one, but the increase in our utility bill is going to just balloon. And I would love to see maybe some modifications to the proposal that would include ceiling fans, because ceiling fans have been shown to reduce HVAC bills by 12%. And it's not much, it's only 12%. You know, my grand idea is all these solar panels that we're gonna get, you know, installed someday, but.
Could we have Josh convolute on that?
I was gonna say, do we have,
hey, Josh.
Board recognizes Josh.
So, the ceiling fan idea is, I'm not gonna say doesn't work, because they do. We're in the gym quite often replacing ceiling tiles from kids kicking balls through the ceiling tiles. I see them being damaged often.
Yeah.
And for the fans you're talking about,
yeah.
We all know the name of them. I probably shouldn't say it, but the big fans, those are very expensive. Between $10,000 and $20,000, depending on the size, I think they would just be absolutely destroyed.
Yeah.
I know they're built tougher than a ceiling tile, but
yeah.
We all know what will probably happen.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Balls will be kicked at them and destroyed. When you say the costs will skyrocket for utilities,
yeah.
That's, yes, they will go up, but we can also, with Johnson Controls, we can program these. We can go in and program when they need to run, when they don't need to run. We don't need to cool the area all summer long.
Mm-hmm.
And we know, say graduation's coming, it's going to be raining, we need to cool it. We can go in, turn them on before, run that program. When it's done, they kick off. Volleyball games in the fall, you know, when it's still warm,
mm-hmm.
we can turn on. They don't have to run 24/7. It isn't like, you know, May 1st, we're switching over to cooling.
Yeah.
And we're cooling the space continuously. That doesn't necessarily have to be the case in the gym.
Okay.
So, yes, they will go up, but not. It isn't like they're going to run 24/7.
And then is there a plan to have, so in some large facilities like that, there's an exhaust system separate from the HVAC system that
we actually have four.
Pulls air in, so like heat can get trapped and it, like the inside of your car when you've left your windows rolled up. So it's easier to pull the heat out and then turn on the HVAC, so we have the ability to do that.
Yeah, so we already currently have four exhaust fans on the gym roof.
Okay.
And they run most of the time. Depends on when they hit a certain temperature in the gym, or we can just turn them on through the computer system. The units will also expel air when they install them too. So it's
without drawing from the building, the other. So when you say expel air, it's not like the, you're saying the HVAC units that they're installing will expel air, but that doesn't mean they're gonna draw from the other facilities.
No, they won't. So the gym is going to be a separate, on its own thing. So it won't pull air from the other facility. I mean, or from the rest of the facility. You might get a little bit of air come through the doors and stuff like that, but for the most part, no.
Okay.
Now, Josh, during the winter, so like right now during the winter, like if you go to a winter basketball game, it's brutally hot in that gym. So is this going to help manage that situation?
Yeah. So what we can do is open up dampers, economizers. We can bring in some fresh air. It should make it all around more comfortable. Johnson Controls knows what they're doing. It'll be set up full confidence.
In the hard winter, sometimes it's hardly tolerable in the stands.
It is. Yeah. It's very hot. Like right now, I know Mr. Corry sent us an email with games and stuff. We'll have the exhaust fans on, and we'll have the heat turned down. But it can
stuff
it's just not. The system that was put in was designed after the building.
Yep.
We all know how those systems work.
Yep.
A system that's designed for the building is going to work better than a retrofitted system generally,
because I've actually had people come suggest to me that we put ceiling fans in there,
just
know?
To move the air
just to move
mm-hmm.
the air, but that's the biggest thing is making sure that this high dollar system we're going to do, that's going to be a lot more comfortable for people, because if it doesn't, we're going to hear about it.
Yeah.
So
well, and you think about it just like your house, you know, you set your air conditioner or heater at 70, it maintains that. We have automatics, so with these rooftops, if it's 70 but it's hot in there, it's going to cool it. If it, whether that means it's in the wintertime, it's going to just open up dampers and bring in 50 degree air to get it down to where it needs to be, or vice versa.
Are these sized for the right ones? I've heard you say several times
yes.
that all the other geothermal
yes.
ones are sized.
We've spent a lot of time. I've been working on this for about a year. I know it was started before I started, and then, you know, with turnover and stuff, but I've been working for about a year between a couple different companies trying to get this done. So there's been a lot of calculations from John to make sure we're going the right way. We took into consideration seating, which is about 1,800 for the gym. So how do we want to do that? What's our average between sporting events and all that? So there's been a lot of calculations put in. So
thanks, Josh. Yep, thanks, Josh. Yep. Any more discussion? All right. Motion to the vote is to approve the memorandum of understanding presented by Johnson Controls to add cooling supplemental heating to the Fairfield High School gymnasium to be paid through ESSER funds. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. All right. Next item on the docket. Recommendation, due to safety concerns of children moving from Pence to the middle school, we need a fence around the playground for the 24-25 school year. I recommend we use Gullet Fence. The amount is $12,081. This would be paid for using saved funds. See attached estimate. Do I hear a motion?
I move approval.
Is there a second? All right, Dave and Mark Thornton. All right. Josh, we're hearing a lot from you. You might as well just stay up here.
I need to describe this one, too. So the reason behind this fence at the middle school around the playground is we have some children coming up from Pence Elementary who are some of our special education children who are flight risk. And to keep them safe and to meet their requirements, we are required to build a fence. But since it serves all of the middle school, because it has to be around the playground, we're not allowed to use special education funding for this project. So we have a little bit of reserves and save for this exact purpose of things like this come up from a time-to-time basis.
What happens in sixth grade and seventh, you know, when they're not on, will they always just be on that fifth grade playground or?
So there's that one playground at the middle school and so, yeah, it's just around that one playground. They
okay.
all share the space at different ones.
That'll all be shared.
Yeah.
That'll be the one. I just want to make sure we're just building one fence one time, not another fence in sixth grade.
Yep. So
okay.
there's just the one playground, and this fence will encompass all of
okay.
that.
You're going to have a second guessing. Is there a second playground?
Well, no, but they do use the open space in the back, and I think
mm-hmm.
that just is further away from the danger, which is the road.
Oh.
So
okay.
would they... would students always just use this one location. They do use out behind the building
uh-huh.
as well, but there's a farther distance from.
Right. And the child in question will be it use that playground.
Okay.
So that's.
Thanks.
Because he likes to run, I guess, is my understanding.
Yeah.
And there's more than you know one. So.
My only other question was, can we use ESSER funding for it? Because it's creating an outdoor play space and keeping safety in mind and save the save funds for something else?
That one is really, really hard to defend as prevent, preparing, or responding to the coronavirus because we're not creating additional space. We're actually consolidating space by putting a fence around an area. So I'd have to be really, really creative on using ESSER funding
well,
on that.
It's allowing a certain population of kids to actually use the outside space. When they wouldn't otherwise, which is...
I 100% understand what you're saying. I would say I'm also comfortable using safe funds,
okay.
which is Fund 33.
As long as
so.
I'm just, you know, these funds go away and we don't have another purpose for them yet, so...
No, that's a great question. I'd be very creative to assess around that.
Did we get any other bids?
I did not. I've worked with other fence companies getting bids on other projects, and Gullet has been the cheapest, and so that's what I called, and they're the quickest. I got a couple bids at the high school for some fencing. The other bids were about $1,500 more than Gullet, so I did not bother. I kind of have an idea of where they're going to be.
Are they the ones that did the Pence fence?
They are. The one that got creamed by the delivery truck.
Did it?
Yeah.
I didn't hear about that.
Yeah.
Recently?
Yeah. Like 5 a.m. a delivery truck come in. He was new. It was after we got the new walk-in cooler and just... I called Bullet and they were there right away.
Really?
So,
yeah. Wow.
We didn't pay for that, though. We didn't have to pay for that one. So, no. In my cost, since I've been here, I've gotten several bids. And each time, Gullet, even though we haven't done all the projects, Gullet's been by far the cheaper. So, that's who I went with.
All right. Any other discussion? Thank you, Josh. Motion to vote is to, due to safety concerns of children moving from Pence to middle school, we will need a fence around the playground for the 24-25 school year. I recommend using Gullet Fence. The amount is $12,081. This would be paid for using save funds. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. All right, we're finally to the policies. recommendation to approve the board policies at first reading as presented. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All right, Mark and Megan. First of all, I want to thank Superintendent Mishler for shortening that so I didn't have to say the title of all of them.
Definitely. Did some investigating that they don't all have to be read with the titles. So
perfect.
They are presented there in the notes for...
So we never had to read them all?
Conciseness.
Really?
No, I've been cringing about that the whole time I've been sitting here.
Really?
We're just looking for ways to be efficient in all aspects of organization.
I enjoyed listening to Christy read that off for 6 months.
All right, is there any discussion on the board policies?
I just want to, are you guys all aware that these take two readings to pass?
Yeah. And so this is the first reading. We'll hear about these again in January.
Correct. With probably some first readings in January as well.
Yep. All right, any more discussion? Hearing none. Motion on the table is to approve the board policies at the first reading as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. All right, and that's the last bit of new business. So, thank you guys all for sticking out this long. Let's move to some highlights. What are some things you guys remember about the meeting? Let's start with Deb.
What?
So, I'm so thrilled that the Donovan was passed because I feel 1,000% confident that we're going to see some great output from their work.
Awesome, Mark Thornton.
Steal from past ones. It's always good to have students here. So I watched some of them sing the other night at the choir concert, so it's good to see them here. It's always good to see the different aspects of the community or the district come, whether it be local or the FFA the other day. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So good to see them. And then I think just the discussion on the budget, I know we all know it's going to be a long journey. So I think the highlight there is just the constructive conversation that was going on there. I mean, there's going to be lots more to add over the next 2 to 3 months, so I think that's just a good start of getting everybody on the same page of asking questions to then derive other questions that people don't really think of as well. So,
great. Christy?
I am just thankful for the other team members to be able to draw on their knowledge and help make me feel more confident, I guess, in my decisions. So that would be my highlight.
Dave?
I'm very pleased that we finally have been able to frame the budget issue
we can't solve any problems until we properly identify it and frame it. And we performed our governance duties, and I think hopefully you have good enough guidance now to go into these long-range planning meetings. So I'm happy that we finally were able to sit down and frame the problem and agree on the assumptions behind the budget.
Absolutely. Megan?
I think it's now Ty can sign the checks for us.
I think they actually make a little stamp for me.
as everyone has said, just the constructive conversations, and this budget is going to be, you know, an ongoing conversation and figuring out ways to be constructive and to hear each other and come out with some action is key. So thank you guys.
Great. Mark?
I think my highlights, first of all, have been the kids singing, you know, at all these board meetings. It's easy to lose sight of what's most important, and just, you know, seeing the kids do their thing, that's really always an enjoyment for me. And then also just the new board members, you know. I kind of felt like I was able to be a little more quiet at this meeting than some of the other meetings. You guys asked a lot of good questions, and plus I had to be a little quiet if we want to get out of here by midnight. So no, everyone's doing a great job. I enjoyed a lot of good questions, a lot of good insights, and thanks to be a really good group, and hopefully we can have a good couple of years here, so looking forward to it. So.
Yep, I'm seeing the folly of having to go last here. You guys stole all the good things I can say. So I'm just going to reiterate, having the kids sing was awesome. You know, just highlighting the importance of music programs in our schools. The great budget discussion. Like you said, they're not going to always be easy. I thought it was very constructive, very respectful. And I think we, got a lot of good ideas out there, so it was really good discussion. I'm looking forward to, this is the first full board meeting with the new board, so I'm looking forward to a lot more great discussions with you guys. So with that, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All right, we got Dave and Christy. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? You better not be.
Thanks, Ty.
It is.
Hello.